Are you searching for the best in online black radio? Then go to blacktalkradionetwork.com, helping you filter through the noise. Real talk, black talk.
The internet is full of half-truths and all-out lies. We've all seen them, and many people on social media complaining about it. Here's your chance to show and prove. WorldAfropedia.com is a black-owned and operated encyclopedia. There are several thousand articles, but we need help. We can't uncover all the truth ourselves. So please, join us and become a writer, editor, or blogger for WorldAfropedia.com today. Every little bit counts. We owe it to the future generations to put the truth out there. Visit WorldAfropedia.com, the African-centered encyclopedia, a global database of African knowledge for the purpose of bringing about global African wisdom and understanding. WorldAfropedia.com.
I have another job for you, Willie.
What's that?
We need money. So I have a bank job case. The only thing about it is I can't have the job connected with the Cobras.
How are you going to do that?
We use Red Beans, Benny Rooster, Pomani, JT, Johnny, and Tom. And you lead the team.
All the yellow niggas, right? Look, man, I am tired of that. I am not passing. I am black. Do you hear me, man? Do you understand? I am black. I'm a nigga. Do you understand me? I was born black. I live black. And I'm gonna die probably because I'm black. Because some cracker that knows I'm black better than you, nigga, is probably gonna put a bullet in the back of my head.
Context of White Supremacy. Gus T Renegade in for another broadcast, hopefully to share constructive information on the system of white supremacy. Today's date, Friday, October 14th, 2016. So I have been told. This is our fifth study session on Sam Greenlee's The Spook Who Sat by the Door. We are picking up. We're kind of in the middle of chapter 15. The audio segments that we are starting with this week, the little snippet that you just heard, that is from the movie based on the book that was released in 1973. That scene is one that we covered last week between Pretty Willie Dubois and Dan Freeman, where they're discussing the bank robbery, and Pretty Willie voices some of his own color consciousness about his light complexion, lack of melanin. That was from last week's section, even though it's not exactly the same as the movie. It's pretty close. And then the segment that you are about to hear is also, I think, one of the iconic moments from the film, where Dan Freeman and Phil Dawson is the police officer, where they're in the car. It's a couple days after the riot started in Chicago after the shooting of the young black teen. And they're having their back and forth discussion. Freeman is trying to feel Dawson out, maybe even recruit him, and kind of challenging some of his ideas as a black enforcement official. But I thought these were two of the kind of more notable scenes from the film. Even that first segment is on Dead Prez's album from 1999, Let's Get Free. They have the little exchange with Pretty Willie. Anyway, we will get started. This is audio segment number one, Sam Greenlee, The Spook Who Sat by the Door. Context of White Supremacy, audio segment number one.
Oh, yeah, I forgot. The pigs over here and the people over there. And never the twain shall meet, huh? Hey, man, I grew up down here, too. And I know these people. Now, there were some good people out there in the streets the last few nights. Not just hoodlums, like they say in the newspapers.
In a scene like this, anybody can get involved.
But that's only going to make it worse. We have to maintain law and order, or we might as well be back in the jungles.
Dawes, the ghetto is a jungle, always has been. Understand, you cannot cage people like animals and not expect them to fight back someday. It has always been an army occupation here, with police badges and uniforms. Huh? You and me, a cop and a social worker, we are keepers of this goddamn zoo.
The streets have to be safe.
Safe for who? You're here to protect property, not lives.
Well, that's what it's all about, isn't it? You worked hard to get what you got, didn't you? And you want to keep it just like I do?
Bullshit. Listen, you think because you got a badge and I got a couple of degrees, that makes a difference? Do you know what white folks call people like you and me in private? Niggers, dogs. Niggers.
They drove through the checkpoint and on to 47th. They stopped first for a drink in a dark, air-conditioned bar and watched the Cubs playing San Francisco on the television set there. They watched long enough to see Willie Mays double in two runs and then walked the short distance to the small restaurant, ordered, and ate in silence, each comfortable in the old friendship and lost in their own private thoughts. When they had finished, Dawson drove Freeman to his car, parked just outside the riot area. Easy, Dan. Don't let these board members string you out. You better hope not, because if they do, I'll join the force and take your job in a couple of years. Dawson laughed as he drove off. You might make a pretty good cop. We'd make a good team. Freeman smiled and waved. Yeah, he thought, we could make a damn good team, but not working for Mr. Charlie. He drove to his office not far from the university in the Hyde Park District and on the opposite of Washington Park from the riot area. He entered the paneled reception room decorated in Danish modern and smiled at the pretty colored receptionist. Afternoon, Mr. Freeman. Mr. Stevens wants to see you before the meeting. Everybody shook up today. Thanks, honey. I'll try not to lose my cool. He walked down the hall and past Stevens' office into the toilet. As he washed his hands, he checked his mask in the mirror for slippage. This was not the time to arouse suspicion. The face that returned his stare in the mirror was sincere, serious, concerned, and just a bit worried that it might lose a five-figure salary because the natives had been restless last night. His mask was perfect. He dried his hands, adjusted his tie, and walked down the hall to reassure the white folks. The board members were talking nervously in Stevens' outer office. Stevens' secretary motioned Freeman into the inner office when he arrived. Hello, Dan. I'd like a brief report before we convene the meeting. Needless to say, most of the board members are rather agitated about this thing. I understand you were there for most of the worst of it. What happened? Same old thing. The heat was getting to the cops and the people over there, and there had been the usual increase in head whippings for the summertime. Then a cop shot a kid and upset a lot of people. They had almost quieted down when they brought dogs in, and that was like touching a match to gasoline. How was it over there? Pretty bad. Looks as if they might have to call in the guard. I don't think the police can handle it now. How about the street gangs? They're in it, but only one. The Apaches are spearheading anything. No, it's not a hoodlum scene like they say. The whole neighborhood is involved. If not actively, then they support it. What do they hope to gain, Dan? This kind of thing could make it worse for them instead of better. Stevens played nervously with a small bulldog pipe and stared at Freeman intently. They don't hope to gain anything. They don't have any hope anymore. They're convinced nobody gives a damn about them and their problems. They're fed up with being ignored, pushed around, and taking crap, and now they're kicking back. Revenge?
No, not revenge. Retaliation. There's a subtle but important difference. For a moment, Stephen's face opened and disapproval of Freeman showed there briefly, as if Freeman had been personally responsible for the rioting which now threatened their jobs. Stevens looked down quickly at his desk blotter, the blotter a pale shade of violet held in place with hand-worked Florentine leather. When he looked up again, he had a warm, if somewhat tight, white liberal smile on his face. "Dan, I've spoken to most of the board members, and they're very upset that the money we've spent to prevent exactly what happened last night has been wasted." "I disagree, Steve. Street gang activity among the rioters was at an absolute minimum, and the Cobras weren't operating at all. The Riot Control Task Force report will substantiate that." Stevens leaned forward eagerly toward the first sign of hope that morning, like a dog who does not really believe the bone being held out invitingly will be offered. "That's good news. Do you think the Foundation can take any credit for that?" His white liberal glow increased, and Freeman fanned the embers. "Of course. If it hadn't been for the Foundation, those kids would have been directly involved and the damage infinitely worse." "I hope you can confirm this in the meeting, Dan." Stevens licked his lips nervously, hitched his pocket handkerchief, and patted it into place as if to be certain his heart still beat beneath it. "There's talk among the board to dissolve the Foundation. Burkhart has been particularly critical. You know what it would mean to have the Foundation ended. Jobs like ours don't grow on trees." Freeman allowed a moment of panic to show in his eyes, then looked out the window as if to contemplate the horrors of job hunting. He thumbed through his masks and chose one of smiling confidence. "I picked up a copy of the report of the chief of the riot task force first thing this morning." He opened the slim attaché case he had placed at his feet and offered the report to Stevens like a tranquilizer. He spoke in clipped, somewhat more white-type tones than usual. "It indicates that street gang activity was a minor factor in the rioting and cites us by name as the major reason for the inactivity of the gangs as units in the rioting." Stevens leafed through the report. "Good thinking, Dan. This report could prove invaluable. If we can come through this crisis unscathed, we should be a cinch for the board grant. And you know that means substantial raises in pay and allowances for both of us, and nationwide prestige as well. Yes, I think this report plus your own oral presentation today could turn the trick. We have to increase our budget, not kill the Foundation." "Precisely," said Freeman. Stevens decided to fill his pipe. In moments of doubt, his pipe somewhat made him feel wiser and more secure. "I talked to the chief on the phone this morning, Dan. He had high praise for your activity last night." "Perk was there too. He did a damn good job. I'd like it mentioned in his personnel file." "Of course, Dan. Draft a statement and I'll endorse it. I think we'd better go into the conference room now. This will be a tough session." "I don't know," said Freeman. "It's a lot tougher across the park." Stevens opened the meeting and Freeman gave a brief report. Burkhart spoke up. "I might as well be frank about this thing. I'm beginning to have serious doubts about the worth of this Foundation. We spend a good deal of money to prevent this very kind of thing, and I wonder if we want to pour good money after bad. He wore heavy, horn-rimmed glasses, too big for his nose, and he pushed them back up with a nervous gesture of his right hand. The streets aren't safe. What's to prevent some of those hoodlums from coming into Hyde Park to continue their burning and looting? I've sent my wife and children to her mother's in Winnetka, and I've loaded my shotgun, deer rifle, and pistol. Stevens spoke soothingly. We're all concerned about this kind of thing, Burke, but I don't think it's as bad as all that. Dan here reports that street gang activity is at a surprising minimum, and the commandant of the riot task force confirms it, and he has high praise for Dan here and our foundation. Furthermore, the King Cobras, the potentially most dangerous gang in the area, is not functioning in the riot as a unit, and that is the outfit which had our top priority when Dan was brought in. Well, that is good news. Perhaps the papers have exaggerated a bit, but still, we are less than a mile from the major rioting. What's to prevent it from spilling over into our neighborhood? Professor Thompson of the Department of Sociology and Social Welfare at the University of Chicago and a foremost expert on juvenile delinquency spoke. Well, Burke, we found that people from lower income groups, and particularly the culturally deprived and socially disadvantaged, seldom cross what we term natural urban barriers, such as the Midway Mall, an expressway, large busy thoroughfare, or Washington Park, for instance. The park acts as a natural buffer, and I think we need fear little in that sense. Fortunately, there are no middle-class areas contiguous on the riot area, and there is little chance for the rioters to single out people better off than they as targets of their discontent and frustration. What you mean, baby, is that there are no white middle-class areas contiguous on the riot area, thought Freeman. The slum portion of the ghetto ends at 61st. But Freeman didn't think they would attack other Negroes, even the black middle class. I would tend to agree with Steve that our organization has performed well beyond the level to be expected, that our activity among the youth of the neighborhood could act as a restraining factor even in this moment of dramatic social disorganization, is little short of remarkable. In fact, I intend doing a paper concerning our role among the rioters for presentation at the next National Convention of the American Society of Sociologists, if Dan would be so kind as to contribute some of his own observations. What you want, Professor, is for me to write the damn thing for you so you can inject some sociological gobbledygook and call it your own, Freeman thought sourly, but his expression never changed. The board meeting continued, and after Freeman indicated what was planned, once things quieted down in the riot area, Stevens adjourned the meeting. They filed out, stopping to shake Freeman's hand, smiling and calm now, no longer afraid, because Freeman was a good nigger. Their nigger, and he would protect them from the others. Even Burkhart, who had always been awkwardly brusque with Freeman, smiled, pumped his hand, patted him on the back, chattered small talk at him, and suggested they have lunch together one day. That's what they hired me for, thought Freeman. The house slave to keep the dangerous, dumb, nasty field slaves quiet. And now that they know that it's only niggers raising hell in their own neighborhood, they feel fine. He watched them from behind his mask, betraying nothing, smiling, saying the right things automatically. Then they were gone and he was alone in the room with Stevens. Well, Dan, I think that went much better than we had any reason to expect. I'd reminded them all before you arrived that you had predicted trouble of this kind this summer, and I think they were pleased at the report regarding juvenile activity last night during the rioting. I think there's a raise in this thing for you. What about the street workers? Of course, the street workers too, but that will have to await the grant from Washington. But I'm requesting an immediate increase in your salary at the next official board meeting, and I can see no opposition on the horizon. How about dinner? Freeman couldn't eat with this white man, not after last night. He knew he might lose his cool and blow his cover. I don't think so, Steve. I've got a lot of checking to do before the staff meeting tomorrow afternoon. As soon as things settle down over there, I'm putting the entire staff of street workers into the area and we'll have to work out a crash program. Good idea, Dan. Next week, then. As he turned to leave the conference room, Freeman silently handed him his forgotten pipe. Freeman drove the few blocks to his apartment, took a steak out of the freezer compartment to thaw, put a potato in the oven to bake, and made a lettuce and tomato salad. He walked into the living room and turned up the air conditioner, then mixed himself a martini. He sat down and sipped the drink slowly, waiting for the steak to thaw, looking at the Japanese Buddha head of black volcanic stone. He had never thought that he would enjoy what he would do, and now that the time had arrived, he knew that he would not enjoy it at all. But that would not change things any. He wondered how many of them would be alive this time next year, and he wondered how many more they would kill tonight. The papers had reported 3 killed, but he had seen 5 dead the night before on 51st alone, target practice with live ammo and live targets. But then, the bullseye of every target he had ever seen had been black. Chapter 16. Freeman strode through his apartment, tense and restless from the foundation board meeting. His cover was even more secure than ever. He would be free to roam the area, befriend the troops and cops, gathering intelligence as an almost invisible agent, but he would never enjoy deceiving whites. Even in that meeting, one part of him was crying to tell them what he thought and felt. But he couldn't afford to yield to that temptation. There was too much at stake. He roamed his apartment, turned up the air conditioner, and moved to his records. He hesitated in front of the Miles Davis records, then moved to the blues. He chose Muddy Waters, John Lee Hooker, Lightnin' Hopkins, Big Bill Brunzi, and put them on the changer. He stood midway between the speakers and listened to the first few bars of Hoochie Coochie Man, then walked into the kitchen and filled a Danish teakwood ice container. He mixed a martini of 4 parts Beef Eater's gin to 1 part Noli Pratt vermouth over the rocks in an old-fashioned glass. He walked to the Saarinen womb chair and sat sipping his drink and listening to the music. He gazed around the room, and there was not a mistake in the cover. It reflected perfectly the superficial, materialistic, white type, middle-class Freeman. By any contemporary definition, Freeman was a nigger who had made it in white society. He had everything any red-blooded American boy could want, and for a nigger, wow. The apartment gleamed and glistened with chrome, formica, aluminum, and steel. shone gently of well-polished wood, bulged with grown-up toys, color television, stereo, videotape, exotic carvings and knives. He dressed fashionably and well, read the right books and magazines. The pay for sellout niggers increases annually, he thought. Yes, the Negro profession is really swinging nowadays, but it looks like I'm going to throw a little shit in the game. When whites find out what they must really know down deep inside, that niggers like me don't really communicate with or control the rest, a whole lot of cats like the fake Freeman will be on the outside looking in. And where will I be after the deal goes down? Can't think about that. Got to take it one day at a time, make sure the thing won't end if they get to me. When did it all start? When did I really know that Whitey was nowhere for niggers? It would be so easy to sink into the softness of this scene. Let's face it, he thought, I like this shit. I drive a beautiful piece of machinery, drink good whiskey, wear good clothes, and have more chicks than I can really handle. It would only take a little lying to myself to think I was really into something. Tell myself I'd earned it all in the best Horatio Alger tradition. Put down all the spades, too lazy to do what I've done. But Whitey helps. He might tell you that you're different from the rest, and in the next breath remind you you're all the same underneath your manicured fingernails and J-press suit. The ghetto had been a refuge in his childhood. He had had no close contact with whites until he entered a high school split almost 50-50 white and black. But it was two schools as rigidly separated by unspoken rule as if someone had painted signs saying white and colored. Freeman hadn't thought much about the whites. He had his own colored friends. It happened during the beginning of his second year, just after the war, with the black veterans returning from the War of Freedom, bitter and disillusioned. It happened on a bright autumn Chicago day. It was sweater weather, gray, and the sun peeking through now and then, and the wind toward the lake. The football season was to start that Saturday. The big red streetcar moved down 63rd Street under the L tracks like a big bug in a tunnel. It was crowded by the time it reached South Park Avenue. A nice crowd. A laughing, friendly, teasing brown and black crowd. When it reached Stewart and the crowd tumbled off, laughing and loud, there was another car on the corner across the street. An eastbound streetcar, and its crowd was mixed. Black, brown, and white. The sun was out now, and the students would be sitting on the low concrete wall in front of the school, some on the porch of the sweets shop across the street, the girls laughing soft and low, their teeth flashing white in their brown faces. The leaves should be dropping off the trees, and a football silhouetted against the blue, gray, and white sky, a blackjack game in the alley, and the school cop ready to saunter conspicuously across the street a few minutes before the bell rang to see that the gamblers weren't late. It wasn't like that. It was frozen. The few smiles were frozen. The sullen looks and the uncertain frowns were frozen. The battered football lay on the sidewalk unnoticed, and the laughter deep down in a pretty brown breast was frozen, and the group of white faces on the steps of the frame house across the street from the school were frozen with bleak, determined looks. Then it started from the porch, from the white faces, low and weak, and then getting stronger. Old Black Joe. I hear those darkies' voices gently calling. No breathing in brown throats, and then a slow movement to the curb, and the bored cops in the squad car on the corner didn't look bored anymore. The singing faltered for a second, and then the voices got stronger. I hear those darkies' voices gently calling. In the street now, and the squad car turning its engine over, and no laughter and no smiles, and now fear in pretty blue eyes, a defiant sneer above a black leather jacket, and a sign pulled into view. We won't go to school with niggers anymore. I hear those voices gently calling. A ring around the porch now, a black and brown ring, and the black leather jackets and blue eyes and blue jeans and white faces, black hair and blonde hair on the porch, standing on the steps now, and hate, hate in white faces, in brown faces, in black faces. A white handkerchief flashed in the sun, was wrapped around black knuckles, and another, the sun glinted on a knife blade, and the street was full now, and the squad car pulling out from the curb, and the cop talking into the microphone. I hear those voices. White handkerchief around black knuckles, and knives along their legs, and no more song, and no one seemed to breathe. A bottle shattered on a curb, and a tense black boy moved toward the porch, the bottle's jagged neck in his fist. Look out, gonna get me a goddamn old fay today. The cops out of the car, then in the car, the black boy inside, and the crowd moving around the car, pressing close, and fear now in the fat, flaccid faces inside, not bored anymore. The car rocking, rocking, rocking in a sea of faces, black faces, brown faces, yellow faces. Fear and hate and curses, and then a voice, a bass voice from a brown face over the crowd noises clear. I hear those darkies' voices gently calling. The crowd picking it up and the car rocking in rhythm. Let him out, white man. Let him out or we open this car like a sardine can and come get him. And we get you too, white man. We get you good. Get back. Go on to school, you kids. I hear those voices. Let him out. The car rocking in a dark sea. Better let him go, Jim. They got some squads on the way. The black boy back in the street. The crowd milling around. Then a movement toward the forgotten porch. Empty now. The leather jackets. The long hair. The blue eyes and blue jeans gone. And the sign on the steps. We won't go to school with niggers anymore. No song and no smiles. The sun is out in its sweater weather with the first football game Saturday, but no laughter from pretty brown throats. No blackjack game in the alley. No football against the sky and the sun on a sign on the porch. The martini was sour with the memory. He put it down and left the apartment. The stereo would shut itself off automatically. As he closed the door, he heard Brunzi. If you white, all right. If you brown, stick around. But if you're black, get back. Get back. He walked out into the warm air of the street and began walking, ignoring the car. He found himself on East 47th at Drexel Boulevard. He crossed, and answering the smell of broiling barbecue, he walked into a shop on the north side of the street and ordered a plate of short ribs with medium hot sauce. He walked outside and headed west again, took the paper plate from the bag, and holding it in his left hand, tore off a rib, eating as he walked. Except for the passing motorized National Guard patrols, the ghetto seemed normal again. The burning had been light this far east. West of South Park Boulevard, it was much worse. He finished the ribs, coleslaw, and French fries just the other side of Langley, wiped his hands on the paper napkin, then rolled the bones in the paper plate and bag, placed it in a garbage can. He stopped in front of a record store and entered. There was an Otis Redding record playing on the speaker outside. The girl behind the counter was dancing to the music, and Freeman joined her. They smiled at one another across the counter. He pointed to the 45 RPM record on the turntable when it had finished, and the girl placed it in a bag for him. "Sweet thing, what time you get off work?" he said. "Sorry, baby, but my old man's picking me up. You know, Uncle Tom." "Well, I sure wouldn't want to mess with him, but every chick I see says that's her old man." He smiled. "Well, baby, he could be any of them. He could even be my old man." "Sure could. So treat him right." "Honey, I've been taking good care of him since the thing started. He was out in them streets the night it started and wasn't nothing but man. Whole lot of men got made that night." "Better believe it. Lots of cats walking tall out there and chicks digging it." And she was right. There was pride and defiance in the ghetto in place of sullenness and despair. There were jokes about the National Guard everywhere. Freeman stood on a street corner and watched four men loud talking for a small audience of their friends. Each would sustain a comic monologue as long as he could about the white soldiers of the National Guard and would have to move off stage for another when his comic inventiveness became exhausted. Freeman moved on, still chuckling. Thirsty, he turned into a small, dark bar. He paused just inside the door, allowing his eyes to accustom themselves to the gloom. Recognizing a woman at the bar, he walked over to her. "Hello, Mrs. Duncan. Mind if I join you?" "Fine." He motioned to the bartender and ordered a Ballantine's ale. "How's your son? He hasn't been hanging out on the block, and some of the boys are worried about him." "Shorty don't have time to hang out. He got a job now, making good money. Just bought me a new color TV." "The boys say he's not just pushing, but he's hooked." "Now, he ain't really no junkie. I mean, sure he shoot up every now and then, but most of the kids do that nowadays. They don't seem to like whiskey much. He say he ain't hooked. I don't imagine he got more than a $20, $30 a week habit, and that ain't no habit at all. Woman down the hall where I live, now she got a habit. If she don't get a fix when she need it, well, we all got to go down there and hold her down and clean up when she gets sick and all. Sometime us people got to be with her day and night. We got to take turns. Now that's a habit. My son ain't got nothing like that. No, sir." "Did you ever think he might wind up in jail?" "Not unless somebody put some heat on the precinct station and the fuzz need to bust somebody, and then he won't have to do more than 5-6 months and the people he worked for be putting money away for him all that time. but they like him a lot. Say he a smart boy, so I don't think they choose him to get busted, even if the heat's on. Does he ever think about going back to school? He don't want no part of school. You know how them teachers is. They hate us, and sometimes the colored ones the worst. How come they hate us? Fear. What they got to be afraid of? Seemed like they got everything going for them. Did you ever think Shorty might get some kind of regular employment? Mr. Freeman, don't start coming on like a social worker. Everybody know you hip to our scene. You about the only social worker they got any time for. How he gonna get a job? Time was, when I first came up from down south, there was plenty work, but there ain't nothing nowadays. Steel mills done automated, and the stockyards moved to them states where they don't like unions. You mean the states with the right to work laws? Yeah, them states don't like unions, and the factories moving too. And down south, ain't that something? We came up here to work in them, and they moved the factories back where we come from. Mr. Freeman, you know it ain't no work for us, less it's out there in them streets. Yeah, he said softly, almost to himself. He finished his beer, motioned the bartender, and paid for hers as well. Well, tell Shorty I said hello. I sure will. He just like the rest of the boys. Think you really swinging. Thanks for the drink. She returned her attention to the television as he left the bar. He ran into Shorty, dapper in a lightweight suit, skinny brim straw hat, and wraparound shades. Hey, Turk, how you doing? Cool, Shorty. Just saw your mother inside. She been kinda worried about what's been happening. Think we can do anything to help her? Freeman turned to look at the bar. No, Shorty, he said as he moved away. She doesn't need any help from us. He slowly retraced his steps along 47th, walking home. It was dusk now, a few hours before curfew. The streets were full of people, the neon flashing, red, pink, and blue on the dark skins of their faces. He listened to the music and sounds of his home, sniffed the smells. He turned south on Drexel Boulevard and walked along the almost deserted street toward Drexel Square. Automobiles made a wide circuit of the riot area in case there might be another outbreak. The hot air became hotter and more still. There was no breeze blowing at all. Then there was a faint stirring from the lake to the east and the first faint smell of rain. He had just crossed 50th Street when the first big drops came down splashing on the pavement still hot from the day's sun. The rain increased and there was first the musty smell of the concrete sidewalks, then the sharper smell of the asphalt, and as it increased, the clean green smell of the trees and grass. One thing about Chicago, he thought, even in the ghetto, there are trees and grass. He smiled to himself. That's supposed to make being black and poor all right. When Watts happened, all them white folks saying, "What they riding for? Why, they got palm trees in that slum." A palm tree lined slum. It could only happen in America. It was raining harder now, and Freeman walked easily through the now deserted street, the cool rain feeling good on his skin. Suddenly, he began to run, slowly at first, and then, as his muscles became warm and loose, faster. It was dark now, the streets beautiful in the faint light from the street lamps and apartment windows, the trees and grass a translucent green. He ran across the street onto the broad strip of grass which ran down Drexel. If a cop comes along now, I'm a dead nigger. Any nigger running at night has got to have done something wrong. He smiled to himself and sprinted the last 100 yards to Drexel Square. He stood near the fountain listening to the water running in it, to the sound of the rain on the streets and pavement. The rain had awakened the clean smell of Washington Park just across Cottage Grove, and from somewhere in the large kitchenette apartment building behind him, he could hear someone playing James Brown. He walked to 55th Street and then east to his apartment building. It was still raining when he entered his apartment, his clothing soaked. He undressed in the bathroom and took a very hot shower, then went into the kitchen wearing his terry cloth robe. Even after the barbecue, he was hungry, and he prepared a cheese omelet and washed it down with Carlsberg beer. He walked into the living room and looked at the unfinished martini he had abandoned when the apartment and his cover, the things he was doing, had closed in on him. He took the glass into the kitchen, poured out the warm martini, and rinsed the glass. He thought of Shorty's mother as he mixed himself a Scotch highball, walked into the living room, and put Muddy Waters on the turntable. He sat listening to his Mississippi Delta sound. I'm ready. Ready's anybody can be. Chapter 17. Freeman met with his staff, Dean, Scott, Stud, and Pretty Willie, one night in the back of the pool room. The riots had continued for 4 nights, and the calling up of the National Guard seemed imminent. But the mayor was milking the riots for every bit of sympathy and publicity that he could muster. His picture was in every paper. There were shots of him on the television newscasts, blaming the rioting on communists and agitators, speaking in his flat, unattractively nasal voice. Politicians were falling all over themselves to get into the spotlight and say their piece, having run out of anything new to say about Vietnam. Since the National Guard would be under the control of the governor, the mayor was reluctant to request its use to put down the riots, but there was increasing pressure to call in troops, and Freeman figured they would be in within 24 to 36 hours at the most. The rioting had leapfrogged the 24 square block area originally cordoned off, and police chased groups in an area as far north as Roosevelt Road and as far south as 61st, and the Negroes in the West Side Ghetto, led by the Comanches, were getting into the act. The police by now were exhausted and resorting to guns more often. The official total of dead was now placed at 28, none of them white. Okay, that's the scene. We make our move on Sunday, but since it looks as if the guard will move in tomorrow night or the day after, we'll have to move some of our equipment outside of the ghetto and stash it. If they impose a curfew and set up checkpoints, we'll have to slip out the best way we can. Daddy will handle the command post. We'll use Stud and Willie's attack teams, and Willie's will handle the demolition. Stud's team will provide cover. We don't want any shooting if we can help it. We'll have plenty of that later. Right now, we want to hit Whitey in his own territory and make him look silly. The white man can handle a put down, but a put on hangs him up. Now the timing has to be perfect or it spoils the propaganda effect. We want a series of dramatic incidents to advertise our existence, and then we can get down to the dirty work we've been training for. We'll go over this thing in detail, just like the bank job, every night until H hour. When Freeman left through the back entrance of the pool room, they were huddled over the plans spread on a pool table. He had been in the streets every night since the riots began, the activity was not as intense except at sporadic moments when a particular act by the cops would arouse people at a spot here and there in the area. Nevertheless, the people of the neighborhood continued to hit back whenever they could. The women shouted insults at the police, white or black, or ignored them as if they did not exist, even when following their orders. The arrests continued in an effort to break the rioting by jailing the ringleaders and troublemakers. The police spent a great deal of time looking for black nationalists and communists, but the riots had been going on for 3 days before they could produce a leaflet having any Marxist-Leninist overtones. The ambulances and vans full of the arrested moved regularly in and out of the area. Emergency rations had to be brought in because each of the supermarkets had been stripped and many of them gutted by fire. The establishment began to retaliate. Social workers increased their harassment, but the white social workers had to be escorted by police. Those few willing to venture into the riot area, welfare checks were held up. The unemployment compensation office on 47th and South Park was closed for renovations. Adult literacy classes were discontinued. Playgrounds were closed. The swimming pools in Washington Park were emptied. A curfew of 10 o'clock was imposed. Bars, liquor stores, and pool rooms were closed. People were stopped in the streets repeatedly by police and searched. Freeman was known throughout the area by now by both the police and people. He chatted with street gangs, not preaching to them, asking a few questions, listening when they wanted to volunteer anything, and they knew he would not carry tales concerning their raiding and looting to the police. Rioting had been largely reduced to the gangs and the older, more bitter and desperate men, unemployed and without hope. But the rest of the community did not object to their activity. They felt it was past time to let the white man know they existed. Freeman knew they no longer gave a damn. Advocates of nonviolence were trucked in by the police from their normal integrated haunts to try and pacify the crowds and were met with general abuse and ridicule. Each night, they met in the closed pool room and went over their plans for Sunday night. 2 days after the first meeting, the National Guard moved into the area. The people were not impressed with them any more than with the police, but they had more weapons and armor. The commander of the guard unit held a press conference full of tough guy cliches and indicated that he expected a return to law and order immediately or else. He did not indicate what "or else" meant, but he was used to giving orders and having them obeyed. He did not expect to have any trouble with the inhabitants of the ghetto and was somewhat dismayed that the police had not been able to handle the riots, but he had become convinced that the police mollycoddled hoodlums. He thought that he and his men could show them how it was done. No one was willing to believe that the rioting was a spontaneous uprising by people disgusted with their lot, least of all the mayor and the politicians. They continued to search frantically for Muslims, communists, black nationalists, and agitators of any political kind, stripe, or spectrum, and proudly displayed any they could arrest for incitement to riot or any literature, pamphlets, or signs they could uncover. The mayor had often blamed Republicans for his trouble, but felt that communists and agitators were more appropriate scapegoats for the rioting. A drab, colorless figure, he was known nationally as a powerful politician in his party, but he was almost a non-entity outside of Chicago. Now his picture was in papers everywhere, and he began to think in terms of national office for the first time in his career. The National Guard commander, Colonel Archie Bull Evans, shared a common trait among military officers. He was a loudmouth fool. He had tried to stay in the regular army after the war, but could not bear giving up his gold major's leaves for the stripes of a staff sergeant, and returned to his hardware store in suburban Aurora, joining the National Guard, and in the ensuing years attaining the rank of full colonel, commanding an infantry National Guard regiment. His regiment was sloppily trained and ill-disciplined, but because of the colonel's mania concerning spit and polish, impressive in garrison and on the parade grounds. The colonel himself was a model of military dandyism, as impressive in uniform as he was nondescript in mufti. He wore a beret of infantry blue and the infantry blue ascot, pre-knotted and with hidden snaps at his throat. There were the green tabs of the combat officer on his epaulets, pinned there by the regimental insignia. His uniforms were tailor-made and of tropical worsted or tropical gabardine. He wore spit-shined paratrooper boots made for him by a bootmaker in London. He wore a pearl-handled, silver-plated Colt 38 and carried a Malacca swagger stick. The colonel wore his hair in a close-cropped military brush and surrounded himself with short staff officers to minimize the effect of his 5'7.5" height. He had a short, thick neck and powerful shoulders and arms and a deep chest, and he loved to arm wrestle larger men and beat them. Colonel Evans' first press conference was a near disaster, and the television crew was relieved that they were filming on tape instead of live because of his profanity. He told the members of the press that he intended teaching the people of the area respect for law and order, and that there would be no further nursemaiding of them. He said that he did not believe in special treatment for Negroes. They should stop whining and start working and earn the respect of the white citizenry by demonstrating their worth. Within 24 hours, he announced that things were back to normal and that they are back on the bottom and we are back on the top. "Man," said Freeman after reading Evans's comments in the papers and observing him on television, "that cat couldn't be any better for us if we ordered him special." Within 36 hours, Evans had solidly united the inhabitants of the riot area, many of whom had tired of the rioting and disruption, a public relations feat of major proportions. Freeman observed the guard unit with an ex-infantry company commander's trained eye and noticed its defects beneath the glitter. "It's a jive outfit, not much better trained than a Boy Scout troop. They're a drag by National Guard standards. First sign of pressure, though, and they're going to be trigger-happy as hell. They'll probably waste a lot of people. But when we're ready, they won't be hard to get rid of at all. Man, that colonel is so stupid. I wonder how come he's not a general."
Context of White Supremacy. That is our first audio segment. Folks have comments, observations they would like to share, feel free to dial in the number 641-715-3640, the code 564-943-pound. Press star 6 if you would like to participate. That number again, 641
715-3640. And the code is 564-943-pound. Press *6 if you would like to participate. If you do not want to use your phone to dial in, you can use the free VOPE line. It is linked at Black Talk Radio Network. If you need that address, it is tinyty.cc/1race. And that is the number 1. So the address again, tinyty.cc/1race. And that is the number 1. When you put in that address, click the link on the left of the page. It says free vote line. When you click that, it will open a small window on your screen. The first line, it is a drop down menu. Select the number I just gave out, which again is 641-715-3640. The code, which is the next line, is 564-943. Final line, it will ask for a name. You can use a real name, a nickname. You can just press random keys, whatever you're comfortable with. Once you get all that entered, click the green button at the bottom. It will connect you to the live broadcast. You should be able to hear us. It is the same procedure. If you would like to participate, you'll see the dial pad on your screen. Press *6. When you do that, you'll hear the audio prompt to press 1. Press number 1. I'll see your hand on the switchboard, and we will get you on the line. Right on. All the folks who dialed in, if you have a commentary you would like to share, line should be open. Looking forward to hearing your observations.
Yes, may I be heard?
Yes, sir.
May I be heard?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Greetings, Gus. Greetings to the other callers and listeners. I'll start my commentary off with when he was talking to Dawson in the car, and they had a difference of opinion about the way they were looking at things. And then he told Dawson, you know what whites call people like you and I in private? He said, what, niggers? So after that, Dawson told him to cool it. But then Freeman, he didn't believe that Freeman believed the stuff that he was talking about. So he was just kind of throwing it off. And then Freeman said, yeah, I guess you're right, Dawes. It does bug me to see all that work go down the drain when things quieten down again. I have to start right from scratch. How long you been on the force? See, he was actually telling Dawson, you know, what his intentions was, but Dawson is so lost in his own world, you know, that he can't see what Freeman is actually telling him. And then later on, Freeman attempts to recruit Dawson. But when a person is in a state of reality, I call it an altered state of reality, about what's really going on and how things really are, you can't even see your position in there, let alone anyone else's or a bigger picture of what's actually happening. So it went on where Freeman was thought that, you know, after the National Guard would get here and Dawson would see how they end up treating the people, then he would have more reason to come on his side. And I'd say, you know, it's a slight chance of that happening. And I like the way that Freeman conducted himself when he went into the meeting. Of course, he had to put on another mask. But then when he summed it all up and said that the people were quieting down until they brought the dogs in, and that was a torch, a match, like a torch, a match to gasoline. So he blamed it on the police, which the blame should be on the ones who's causing the problems that causes the riot in the first place. And then the police come down to actually exacerbate the situation, bring the dogs in, and then somebody gets killed. And then the way they were trying to move the meeting in a way that saying that, are they out for revenge? And Freeman told him, no, retaliation was different than revenge. There's a subtle but important difference. So he carried himself quite well, and the head of the so-called, I guess, foundation, Burkhart, you know, had been practicing racism, not even knowing Freeman, because when they first had their interchange, he came in. He had always been cold and you know, unconcerned about him in the first place, and then came in actually to have him lose his job. And I like the way that Freeman was prepared with documentation, police reports on what really happened, and he gave an accurate description. And the phony Professor Thompson from the Department of Sociology from the university, you know, was only there to use the suffering of people for his books and later his speeches, and using code words like lower income groups, socially disadvantaged, those culturally deprived, code words for black people. This book is full of examples of racism. Mostly it don't reveal any complex, I guess, racist strategies from whites that we don't already know, but it gives an insight of the way that black people think about the situation that we're in and what our reactions are. From the type Dawson and Freeman, two opposites, the women, the prostitute and Joy, you know, were supposed to be opposites, but similar in some ways. And then these characters are all interesting. So the last thing I wanted to say was that when he was talking about himself, you know, Freeman went back home, and of course he's living great. He's got a nice apartment with all the latest, you know, gadgets, and he's in, I guess, in a middle-class neighborhood. And he said, the pay for sellout niggas increased annually, he thought. Yes, the Negro profession is really swinging nowadays, but it looks like I'm going to throw a little shit in the game. So, but in actuality, he's doing what each one of us do when we have to put on the face and deal with the system every day, no matter how we think or how we choose to work against racism and against the system of white supremacy. We still are going to be in that Negro profession, I guess. So I'll mute my line and give somebody else a chance. Thanks for taking the call, Gus.
Good hearing from you, Mr. Demery Ford. Other folks who wanted to participate?
Lovehead?
Yes, ma'am.
Hi, everyone. I like how he went into the revenge versus retaliation and gave a clear explanation of how there was difference, major differences between the two. And I like how he started describing the guy that they bought in, page 205. He wore spit shine paratrooper boots made for him by a bootmaker in London. He wore a pearl-handled, silver-plated Colt 38 and carried a Malacca. Malacca? Swagger shtick. I mean, it was, he was explaining like a John Wayne type or a Patton type of person that's about to come down from Washington or wherever he was and get the niggers in line in Chicago. And the last part that you read on page 206, man, that curse so stupid. I wasn't even not a general. I thought that was hilarious. This is a good reading, and I just have those two things to say. Thank you.
Appreciate that. Appreciate that. Yes, sir.
Good evening, guys. Good evening. I'm Paul Collins, Mr. Demery, everyone else on the line, and the ladies who just spoke. I just wanted to really say, got a welding moment in here, huh? You're black. I started cracking up. She would say that at least 5 or 6 times every time she came on the show. Yeah, this book is really good. It's getting into the good parts. The lady just pointed out how it ended, you know. Surprised he's not a general. and he would know because he was in Washington with them. But he would know. Just the whole mindset and everything, like Mr. Dimity said, a lot of instances of racism, but nothing new. They still run the same exact tactics, same game. Everything is done the same way as it was then, and it works very efficiently. That's all I really want to say for now. I'll mute my line.
Can I be heard?
Yes, sir.
Greetings to you, Gus. Greetings to Thomas in New York, Mr. Demery, all the callers and listeners, and again, the black sister that previously spoke. Just to piggyback off of what Thomas just said, it's so true, the tactics, they repeat them because, you know, I don't think we've adequately learned the system and how they function, so they keep getting away with the same thing. It kind of made me think of Donald Trump getting away with not paying his taxes for 18 years and Wesley Snipes going to prison. So, you know, it's the same thing. It's just the same thing. White people can do what they want, and black people get buried under the jail, sadly. Just to get into the book, I think that Mr. Greenlee had exceptional insight into the human condition. Just from the characters and how he wrote them, I think that he has quite a bit of experience, and I can't even imagine how observant he must have been to observe the behavior of both black and white people to the point that he could write such incredible characters that are well-rounded in the way that they function as far as how he utilizes them in the book to tell the story. On page 184, he writes, furthermore, the King Cobras, the potentially most dangerous gang in the area is not functioning in the rioting as a unit. And that is the outfit which had our top priority when Dan was brought in. Well, that's good news. Perhaps the papers have exaggerated a bit, but still, we are less than a mile from the major rioting. What's to prevent it from spilling over into our neighborhood? Then he writes on page 186, well, Dan, I think that it went much better than we had any reason to expect. I have reminded them all before you arrived that you had predicted trouble of this kind this summer, and I think they were pleased at the report regarding juvenile activity last night during the rioting. I think there's a raise in this thing for you. Well, what about the street workers? Of course, the street workers too, but that will have to wait. You'll have to await the grant from Washington. But I'm requesting an immediate increase in your salary at the next official board meeting, and I can see no opposition on the horizon. How about dinner? And so on. And Freeman says he's about to lose his cool and blow his cover. But I found those two sections telling. In the first portion, where they're discussing the potentiality of the rioting moving to the white neighborhood, that's always their fear. I see that any time there's rioting, that's always the case, that they think that way. But black people are smart enough to know that if they go into those white neighborhoods, it's going to be Duck Dynasty all over the place. They're going to be shooting wholesale. It's going to be Katrina all over again. So it's funny that this kind of thought process was placed in the book, because you hear that quite a bit as far as white people fearing black people entering their neighborhoods, but that never happens simply because we know what the consequences of something like that would be. And it's interesting on the second portion where his superior was going to grant him this raise immediately, yet he wanted to delay the ones for the street workers. I found it really great, an example of black self-respect that Dan would even ask about, you know, the street workers, first of all. And then second, what they did is something that white people do. It's a tactic they use to make you feel like you're special. And in the sense that them pushing forward this idea of getting you this raise so quickly, you start to think like, oh, this is a good white person, or this white person really likes me. And it's interesting. I had a meeting with my supervisor today that kind of went in a similar fashion, and the same kind of sentiments that he felt, I felt after the meeting, because I knew that it was just a ruse. White people function as terrorists all the time. So it just was interesting. This section made me think of earlier this afternoon in that regard. And, yes, actually, he says on page 185, the board meeting continued, and after Freeman indicated what was planned, once things quieted down in the riot area, Stevens adjourned the meeting. They filed out, stopping to shake Freeman's hand, smiling and calm now, no longer afraid because Freeman was a good nigger, their nigger, and he would protect them from the others. Even Burkhart, who had always been awkwardly brusque with Freeman, smiled and pumped his hand, patted him on the back, chatted small talk at him, and suggested they had lunch together one day. That's what they hired me for, thought Freeman, the house slave to keep the dangerous, dumb, nasty field slaves quiet, and now that they know it's only niggas raising hell in their own neighborhood, they feel fine. He watched them from behind his mask, betraying nothing, smiling. Saying the right things automatically, and when they were gone and he was alone in the room with Stevens. And this, I just found that really interesting because I find it's that brilliant application of double consciousness where he understands the reality of what he's dealing with, but he's giving them what they want. And as far as making them feel comfortable about the way things are developing, since, like you said, the writing hasn't reach their neighborhood. And it's just very interesting that these concepts are being brought out because it's something that I think still happens in certain cases to this very day. Then there's a section on, the section on page 189 where he writes, I think Mr. Demery actually read the section about the pay for sellout niggas increases annually. And I just found that section really telling as well, simply because these are the things that we get trapped into. A lot of times, just in general, once a black person gains some semblance of, I guess, what most people would term financial success, even though I don't really understand what that is in the system of white supremacy, ultimately we start to think that we're fitting in. And a lot of us who might have that spirit to fight the system, you know, that spirit dies down as you start to live the good life and you get the things that you always wanted since you were a child and never were able to attain via white people opening the doors to you and giving you a few extra crumbs. And it made me think about like 9/11 and how these people come to this country and you would think they would get caught up in what America has to offer as people coming from such strict countries as far as just the rules and the things they're not allowed to do, but they were so dedicated to whatever, you know, horrific thing they were planning to do that they did not get dissuaded or distracted by the American experience. And to me, that's the ultimate part of really fighting the system of white supremacy, is not getting lulled into complacency via getting some creature comforts that comes with the system of white supremacy. You know, if you do whatever white people want you to do for them, or if you behave in a manner in which they feel that you're, you know, a good Negro per se. Mm-hmm. Last thing I wanted to touch on was on page 196. It says, yeah, them states don't like unions and the factories moving too and down south. Ain't that something? We come up here to work in them, and they move the factories back to where we come from. Mr. Freeman, you know it ain't no work for us unless it's out here in them streets. And it was interesting because it made me think of Neely Fuller Jr. and how he always talks about white people not allowing us to settle down. We always moving around. And in this case, it's the job that's moving around. And it's almost like, well, black people left the South to escape white supremacy in the form of being lynched and terrorized by the Klan and other white racist militia groups. And once they got here, they tried to get, you know, the jobs that paid better. And they were, of course, in a safer area. Of course, when the black people moved there, the white people moved down south. And then the jobs went where the white people were. So it's very interesting because these kind of things happen to this day in a lot of the major cities. You know, the unemployment rate for most black males between the age of 18 and 35 is 50% or more. So again, the only jobs out there for young black males in a lot of these cities are the jobs that are in the streets. So it's the same, like Thomas was saying, it's the same situation that's just on replay. And until we get a better understanding of the system and change how we function within it, collectively speaking, the united and independent, but still collectively speaking, we're going to continue to go through the same things. I have a couple other things, but I want other people to chime in as well. Thank you, and I'll mute my line.
Appreciate that, Roz. Other folks who dialed in that we haven't heard from yet, that you all have commentary you wanted to share?
Yes, can I be heard?
We can hear both of you. I guess we'll get the caller 7722. Did you want to go ahead?
Yes, sir. Yes, greetings, Gus. Greetings, the rest of the callers, listeners. This is Lemaine KC. I was taken by a portion of the reading today, specifically the portion dealing with the meeting, the board meeting of the foundation, assuming it's probably a nonprofit, and hearing how Freeman was told, hey, look, man, we can't mess this gig up. We got a real good gig here. You know, five figures is hard to find in this. Let's not mess this thing up. Let's make sure this foundation stays afloat. And coincidentally, I had a conversation today with another non-white male who has a nonprofit. He was telling me about his, white terrorism being practiced against him when he was when he found out about a warehouse full of furniture that nonprofits were donated to nonprofits. And he told me that several of the people in the warehouse would not tell him how to apply to be able to use these furnitures and materials for his nonprofit. He told me about just the terrorism, the classic trifling white terrorism. And as he was explaining this to me, I thought about that portion of the book I had read, and I was like, man, we can really see the insincerity in white people when they say that they're supposedly in these nonprofits, NGOs, organizations that want to help. I mean, Haiti is just a classic example, but there's so many other countless organizations which are simply, like Dr. Kamal Kamban said, white welfare. And these organizations are pumping our communities so that we could fund their five-figure, you know, nowadays it's more six-figure nonprofit CEO salaries. Again, white terrorism has to be stopped. And just how the view that these people, these good white people are out there is truly a fallacy. This scene in the book when they're in the boardroom, it's very descriptive because there's so many of those that play out in real life. I've been in some situations where I've seen that happen, but to have that experience today just brought to mind that scene from the book about how insincere white people are about truly helping non-white people break away from the system and to produce justice. Thank you.
Let's see. Appreciate that, sir. The caller is 6133. Did you have commentary?
Yes. Good evening, Gus, and to the listeners. I think for me, the most vital portion of this segment was when they were having the riots in the cities. And when they cut off the food and the services, that really shows where white power, white supremacy lies is dependence. And it goes to show, like, I think the most important thing that we can focus on right now is minimizing our dependence on the system by finding ways to grow our own food, opening up our own food co-ops, and open up our own private charter schools and things like that. So because it's really us that's keeping white supremacy alive because we're so dependent on the system. And people that I've spoken to who used to work in corporate offices and stuff like that, once they gotten off the plantation, their stress level went down so much. It's like they felt never free before. So maybe 75% of our stress in the system is from workplace racism. And if we can open up our own businesses, get our own farms, gated communities and stuff like that, I think our stress level will go really down, but we've lost our creativity. In the 1870s during Reconstruction was a very, I mean, we were doing so well during that time because we had no choices. We had no jobs. They had no jobs for us.
Kind of pivoted away from the book a little bit.
Okay, yeah. But that's my comment.
I appreciate that. It would be difficult for me to say that black people were doing well during the period known as Reconstruction. This is like when whites are like firmly re-entrenching white terrorism in a different form and killing black people in large numbers, attacking black churches. Like it would be kind of difficult for me to say that black people were doing well, quote unquote, under that period of time. But anywho. If other folks have commentary on the book, please make sure you do not wait until the last minute. Go ahead and dial in. Get your hand up if you have things you would like to share. Some of the things that stood out for this week's section of the reading, I thought there were several Welsing moments in this week's section where Stevens, this is the white do-gooder at the social welfare organization in Chicago, where it says early in chapter 15, Stevens decided to fill his pipe in moments of doubt. His pipe somehow made him feel wiser and more secure. I talked to the chief on the phone this morning, Dan. He had high praise for your activity last night. Dr. Welsing talked specifically. She has a whole chapter on smoking, particularly smoking that white males engage in, cigarettes, cigars, tobacco, pipes, excuse me, where she talks about the more refined racist man, more powerful racist man, where they will have a pipe that very much resembles male genitalia, and that's supposed to represent white genetic annihilation, white genetic inferiority. And particularly with him going to his pipe when he feels insecure, that this is supposed to bolster his manhood, his confidence. I think I've been saying for a few weeks over the text, the use of the term spade in the text, that is what they call a racial slur or derogatory term used to describe black people. I mentioned before when Pretty Willie referred to spades, how spades talked in Chicago when he was having this discussion with Dan Freeman a few weeks back. I think last week Dawes referred to black enforcement officers as spades, saying that they had a few spade cops in the area to try to cool the people down so that they wouldn't riot, so-called. And we had it again this week when Freeman is kind of having this monologue with himself about this double consciousness and having this mask and playing this role as a Tom for the whites at this social welfare organization so that he can, you know, organize and get his plan together. But he says that he kind of got himself together and got this great five-figure job and the best Horatio Alger tradition, put down all the spades, too lazy to do what I've done. And I thought the subsequent couple of sentences where he says, but Whitey helps, he might tell you that you're different from the rest, and in the next breath remind you you're all the same underneath your manicured fingernails and J-press suit. And I think just the use of the term spade in that condition, I think that is a part of thinking that you are different, and that the rest of these niggers or spades, that they just can't get their act together the way that you have. I think that is a part of the contamination, where a lot of non-white people, victims of racism, where we end up being confused. I think Mr. Demery Ford said when you have that alternate reality, not understanding racism or not willing to honestly accept racism, that you can just blame other black people and think bad about, talk down about other black people, use of the term spade. And then even continuing there, I think a lot of black people
have fallen into that and then get unfortunately reminded by whites that, no, nigger, you are not any different from the rest of the spades. I think that has happened to a lot of black people. O.J. Simpson comes to mind. There are a few other black folks as well. When you think you got your degrees or you have a certain amount of money or whatever position that you have, and then you get your reminder. See, moving forward, I think Thomas in New York mentioned one of the other Dr. Welsing moments. The artist name, Big Bill Bronzy, where he has the song Black, Brown, White, where he gives Dr. Welsing's whole thing, if you're black, get back, brown, stick around. Just the fact that that phrasing, that bit of code of acknowledging the racial hierarchy of white supremacy, where the more melanin you have, the more of a threat you are to individuals who classify themselves as white. So the darker you are, oh man, get back, threat. Just the fact that that has been a known, accepted, and much talked about repeated phrase for so long, I think just reinforces the daily truth of racism, white supremacy operating worldwide. The next thing I had noted, the conversation that Dan Freeman has with Shorty's mom about her son, where she very much has accepted the reality. I think the normalization of the drug aspect, now that is unfortunate. I could see that same sort of thing happening now with a lot of different narcotics. I think they're talking about heroin specifically here, where they're talking about, no, he's not a junkie, he just has a little small habit, and you know, these other people that are having all these medical problems and everything, they are the junkies. But where she goes on and she talks about the school aspect, I think she's being completely honest about the reality of the situation. Unfortunately, even if you do get a job and all the qualifications, you're still going to be a victim of racism, and it's still unfortunately highly probable that racists will still find some excuse to not hire you or to not hire you for what you have been trained to do, certainly not going to compensate you in accordance to the amount of education that you have or skill training that you have as well. When he's saying, you know, hey, why doesn't Shorty go back to school? Why didn't he get a real job? She's just like, that's just not the way these things are set up. And I think that happens a lot where you have people that don't have all of the highfalutin degrees and what have you, but they have some understanding of what's happening with racism, white supremacy, and the courage to just state things as they are, making it plain. I thought the portion where they talked about the trees was pretty significant as well. I think we've talked about some of the other areas that whites set up to warehouse black people, how they can be really destitute, no green. I think that's all, even a cliche at times, that there's just no grass, no trees, no greenage in areas where white black people are just going to be stockpiled. It's just going to be dilapidated, shabby housing, and that's about it. To say, you niggas in Chicago, you've got trees. What are you complaining about? Like, you know, settle down. Everything, things can't be that bad. You've got palm trees. I mean, gee whiz. I thought that was a really great line as well within the text. Let's see the portion. I thought it was really eloquently constructed in terms of just giving a really graphic depiction of the white retaliation to the rioting, where he talks about the emergency rations had to be brought in. The social workers increased their harassment, but white social workers had to be escorted by police. Those few willing to venture into the riot area, welfare checks were held up. The unemployment compensation office on 47th and South Park was closed for renovations. Adult literacy classes were discontinued. Playgrounds were closed. Even the children are going to feel it. Like, you know, we'll take all of our little crumbs back that we have allowed you niggers to have. We'll take it all back as punishment. And I think racists do this sort of thing regularly within the system of racism, white supremacy, find ways to retaliate when black people respond correctly, logically, to the system of white supremacy. The arm wrestling that
Major Evans participated in. I thought that was another Welsing moment. And even his name, Bull, another Welsing moment. And for this time period, this book being published in 69, reminding me very much of Bull Connor, and particularly some of the attitudes that he's articulating, that we're going to put them in check. This is what it's going to be. White over black, that's what we came to restore, that kind of gruff, unrefined manner, very much reminiscent of Bull Connor, the sheriff in Alabama who turned the water hoses on black people. And the portion a little bit earlier, this is from chapter 16, when Dan Freeman is talking about his codification, when he says that he had to fight back the urge to tell the white people that he worked with exactly how he felt, to give them a piece of his mind, as they say, but it was not worth the temptation. I thought that was really important, because I think frequently a lot of us, justifiably so, are outraged, disgusted by the daily barbarity of whites. And we want to let them know exactly how we feel on jobs or in other situations. And I think just realizing that, although that's totally reasonable to want to do that sort of thing, that you really want to have a long-term strategy of not just, I'm going to give them a piece of my mind in the next 3 minutes, and then, you know, whatever happens after that, if I get fired or whatever other problems, you know, may come about as a result of whatever gratification I get for telling, you know, this racist off in the next 5 minutes, that might, you know, cause me some trouble down the road. To really have a long range plan where you can get the maximum counter-racist result for what it is that you're saying and or doing. I think that that's really important. Even it reminds me of I'm a Cole Cabral. He's a black writer, attempted counter-racist on the continent of Africa, where he said that we kind of have, I'm paraphrasing, but he says that we kind of have an addiction to wanting to have a public display, a public exhibit of our rage directed at individuals classified as white, when really what would be best is quiet, effective, meticulous planning. That would be way better than just trying to get them told publicly in a few seconds. I will stop there. Some of the other folks that we missed who dialed in, and if you think you have something you want to share, go ahead and get your hand up now. Don't wait till the last minute. Caller from a blocked number, did you have commentary you wanted to share?
Oh, can I be heard?
Yes, Karma.
Yes. Good evening, guests. Good evening to all the other callers. I thought it was interesting when he was talking to Shorty's mother, and as you said, Gus, she was just telling him, hey, this is the reality of the situation. We're facing facts here. This is how me and my son, this is how we're going to deal with white supremacy, and you're sitting up here not respecting the way we have chosen to deal with this. And she, you know, she showed her contempt for him, like, what's wrong with you? You know, this is how we're going to deal with white supremacy. Since white supremacy is there and no one's doing anything about it, who are you to say how we deal with it is not correctly? So, anyway, I thought that was very interesting. So, you know, it's like when he forgot that he really hadn't done anything about white supremacy, and so he's telling other people how they should be, when no one apparently has done anything about this and no one seems to know the solution, and yet he's stopping, he's giving her all these things, and she's just telling him, who are you to tell me how to deal with this when nothing's been done? So, and then in the other situation, when he was on the street, and he would be talking to gang members and everyone, and he wouldn't be offering any advice. You know, he wouldn't be condemning anybody. And they were like, they were cool with him. We see that you understand. You have nothing to say about how we're dealing with white supremacy. And that is the appropriate tactic. And everyone was cool with him because, you know, he kept his mouth shut. He's like, people can see that you don't know what you're doing because nothing has been done about the situation. So I saw the two different ways that people responded to him and the two different ways that he responded to people based on what they were doing in the system of white supremacy. Also, I got to say that that colonel and the National Guard, I work for that guy. I know that guy. I work for him. He is, you know, I'm supposed to say he's smart, but he's such an idiot. I mean, he really is. So I just wanted to say that. I had to say it. And the last thing, Shorty's mom. I can't remember what the right last thing was because I didn't write it down. But that's it. Thank you.
Right on, right on. I got the actual quote from Mr. Cabral. I thought it was one of the better ones that I've read over the years. He says that in the revolutionary process, the desire for visibility is a teething disease, and that massive crowds gathered to make demonstrations of insurrectionary yearning before the enemy makes no sense. Quiet, selective, effective, efficient initiatives will do. Great quote. I think we got all the folks who had a hand up, unless I'm mistaken. If folks have any other comments they wanted to make sure they got in, I did want to ask as well, what are folks' thoughts on what is the difference? Because Freeman says it is significant, the difference between an act of revenge and an act of retaliation within the context it was presented in the book. If folks had thoughts on that as well. But any other commentary folks want to make sure they got in?
Can I be heard?
Yes, sir.
Yes, I thought the quote you just read by Amilcar Cabral was really brilliant, and it shows his understanding of the system of white supremacy, because what he is suggesting black people do is exactly what white people have done and been so successful at dominating us for such a long time. They don't talk about it. They're about it. You know, they might discuss things in hushed tones behind closed doors, but when it's time to execute, they make it happen. And what I find is that, in my opinion, black people going out to demonstrate or telling someone off in public, and just like I described when the black woman went off on the white woman in the street and literally put her life on the line jumping in front of the vehicle, to me, that seems to be a way of us trying to assert our adulthood, because we've been forced to be childlike. And for men, asserting our manhood, this is what we have been taught manhood is to be loud and brash, aggressive, you know, cursing all the time, and just hyper-violent. And that is what we believe manhood is. And I believe that that's just us yearning to try and assert our adulthood and our manhood, because we have been so thoroughly castrated that we're no longer even adults in the system of white supremacy. I found it interesting when you brought up the Shorty's heroin addiction, because it made me think of something. Now we have an epidemic of white heroin addicts, and that's what they're called by the media. And in the black communities, especially like during the 70s and whatnot, if you had a heroin habit, even if it was a $30 a week habit, they would say you had a monkey on your back. And once the heroin habit got to the point where it was out of control, they would say you had a gorilla on your back. So even just the racism implied in drug addiction, and now you look at these white addicts, and none of those terms are used. It's just these are white addicts, and they're victims, and they need help, and you know they need medical help, not jail, and all the other stuff that they're doing. So it really made me think of that as well. And then lastly, oh, the spade. When you brought up spades, if you look at a spade is a phallic symbol. And the job that it has is actually an act of sexual intercourse. So that is another closing moment. The act of the spade breaking the earth is no different than the act of actual sex, because the spade itself is the phallic symbol breaking the earth. So I found that even a multi-layered thing, because it's speaking to the black male phallus as a spade, and it's breaking the earth, which is the act of sexual intercourse. So I thought that was interesting. And to answer your question in regards to the difference between retaliation and what was the other term? I'm sorry.
Revenge.
Just remind me. And revenge. The difference between the two is, to me, the reason why I think you and Dr. Welsing were so brilliant in speaking of the fact that you can't stay mad. Like, you only stay mad, but for so long, revenge is an act of emotion. You know, you're angry about something that was done, and you feel that sort of retribution, whether it's killing the other person, is going to give you some sort of satisfaction. So it's an emotional thing where, you know, it might be done in a moment,
as an outburst of rage, or it might be something that you calculate because that person has hurt you over a period of time and you've calculated their destruction over a period of time. Whereas retaliation is a calculated act to bring homeostasis or balance or justice. So when you are retaliating against a wrong, essentially you're trying to set that wrong right. So there's a difference between the emotional approach, which is very short-lived, and it's just that outburst of rage, and it's not necessarily satisfying. It's not about being satisfied through violence when it's retaliation. It's about bringing justice, bringing balance and homeostasis. That's my opinion on the difference between the two. Thank you, and I'll mute my line.
Have you heard?
Yes, sir.
It's so funny a lot said that, because I wrote down here, revenge, emotional, retaliation, strategic. And that's the way I see it, just pretty much how he laid it out. I think that when black people riot, that's revenge. Somebody just got shot. It's an emotional response. We're going to go break a window or two in our own neighborhood. And that's a revenge move. You know, retaliation would be, you know, we strategically set up cells. We catch the train downtown. We're going to hit Macy's. We're going to bust all their windows. We're going to hit Bloomingdale's. We're going to make a point. That would be retaliation, you know. Neither one would be that effective, but one just takes a little bit more strategy, if that makes sense to you, Gus.
I looked up the definitions before I asked you all's thoughts on that, and if other people have views, you know, feel free to share your thoughts as well. The revenge, when I looked up for the definition for revenge, the action of inflicting hurt or harm on someone for an injury or wrong suffered at their hands. That's the definition for revenge. Now, the definition for retaliation, the action of returning a military attack, a counterattack, the action of harming someone because they harmed oneself. That's the definition for retaliation. I thought it was significant that the language of counterattack or something dealing with a military response is in the definition for retaliation, not revenge.
And that's what I wrote. I wrote revenge, and then I put emotional, and under retaliation, I had calculated and thought out with that. So that's interesting. They linked that with military. I wanted to get this in real quick. Mr. Fuller said something about when there was a riot somewhere, white people had thought black people was going to come over to their side of the town. So they got strapped and even got in trees, he said, and waited for black people to come. They never went over there. That made me think of that when there was a passage in the book that says something about one of these guys were worried that it was going to spill over into the white part of town, and he sent his wife away and all that. And there was that Black Get Back Wellsman moment that I had noted too, and that was already went over. And also with the black part of town was kind of cushioned, I guess. Maybe it was like some train tracks and an interstate and then something else and then the white part of town. And that made me think of redlining, how they kind of already had set that up for us to be in certain places. And that's what I had.
Oh, that reminded me two quick things that I did also want to include. What you just said about having some sort of natural buffer, right, to keep the niggers, whatever location that whites have decided that they're going to dump them in. Since this is Chicago, Beryl Satter, she talked about all that, the redlining and denying black people access in Chicago, specifically denying them access to real estate, property, land. She was on the program in the spring of 2015. But all of that to making sure that there's some sort of natural geographic means of keeping that separation in place. And this is vividly pointed out in Candyman, a flick that's almost 30 years old at this point, where they have a scene where they're talking about a specific set of projects in Chicago, and they're saying they built these condos, and then they stopped and were like, oh, wait a minute, there's no natural barrier here to keep us from the niggers. So we just, you know, said forget the whole project and tore it down and turned it into something else because of where it was situated geographically. But that is extremely important. You'll see that consistently, whether it's a highway, a lake, some sort of public transportation, if it's a subway track or a train track or something. But there's that's almost a cliche, the black side of town. You have to go across the train tracks, some sort of natural barrier to keep the niggers separated. And that can help, too, with the with quote-unquote rioting, because they know these sort of disturbances will happen. That way, you know, we can keep this a little bit better contained as to where the niggers are. The other portion that I thought was also important, oh, it just slipped out. It'll come back in a second. Give me 1 second. I'll share the other thing that I thought was also important. Other folks have commentary?
Hey, Gus, can I say one more thing?
Yes.
Can I be heard?
Yes, sir. I guess we'll get Mr. Thomas in New York first, and then we'll get Mr. Demi for.
Sorry, Mr. Demi. I just wanted to say, white people don't do revenge. You know, white people retaliate. You know, and when Mr. Fuller does the talk about Oklahoma, what happened, and the guy bumped into the white girl with the box, and someone shot, you know, and it started out a little riot, and it got a little rowdy, and white people retaliated. They called in the National Guard, you know, they waited a little while, they got their stuff together, and they went in and retaliated. They didn't go in there on an emotional response. They retaliated. They always do retaliation. They don't do revenge. Even when they did the World Trade Center, they waited. Didn't go right into Afghanistan. You know, they trained a little while. They retaliated. They don't do the revenge thing.
Mr. Demery Ford?
Yes, can I be here?
Yes, sir.
Okay, I wanted to point out to the part in the book where I guess he was describing this scene in Chicago, and things were calm, but some people started singing a song about darkies and all of this, and it was the white people starting something, and then he referred to their pretty blue eyes, you know, and it just made me think about the that book we read, The Bluest Eye, and also the fact that they had signs written that we won't go to school with niggers anymore, and they kind of started this situation, and I think it ended up with someone being a black boy being arrested, and then when by the time the cops got there, you turned around and look at the end of this, the white people are all gone, and the sign is just sitting there on the steps. So you have to be careful about these situations. It could be a ambush where to get you emotional to start a reaction, and then turn around, you'll be the one getting arrested, and they actually started the thing in the first place. And one other thing that I wanted to mention, it slipped my mind, but one phrase it said, the white man can handle a put down, but a put on hangs him up. I thought that was pretty interesting because there is a difference in the put down and the put on. And I'll mute my line on that. Thanks, Gus.
For sure. I actually remembered the portion I was going to comment on. Mr. Demery Ford just brought it up. That scene that he's describing, I think, is a memory from his childhood. Dan Freeman, when he describes the sign being up, we won't go to school with niggers anymore, and this crowd gathers, seems like it's white people there, black people there. I think it's extremely important, the historical context, where there were all these instances of whites in Chicago reacting, you know, notoriously like barbarians about black people trying to get access to housing. That's at Beryl Satter, family property. She was on the program. She deals a lot with that. But, I mean, Dr. King, he said the worst racism he ever experienced was in Chicago. He came in some of these very areas, I think, right? The Hyde Park and Cicero, these are some of the places that are being mentioned in the book. But these places during the 1960s, where it just, there were horrendous incidents of white terrorism. And exactly what you heard in the book, whites coming out in mobs with swastikas and throwing rocks at black people and hurling insults. I think In the Warmth of Other Suns, one of my favorites, Isabel Wilkerson, I think she describes how Mahalia Jackson, when she moved to Chicago, and the horror that she went through just trying to get a house. This is Mahalia Jackson, not, you know, Huey P. Newton or Fred Hampton, some, you know, crazy Black Panther Party member, a gospel singer, and, you know, she was terrorized. So I think that's hugely important. And even deeper than that, this is a real incident. Mr. Greenlee lived in Chicago. I think it's significant that he's describing this childhood memory of seeing this and this rabid response to black people trying to go to school to get education, seeing that as a child and how it impacted him. You had a lot of black children, Dr. Welsing even talked about that, who saw these types of events over what they call school integration or housing integration, how that scarred them, how that traumatized them, how it impacted them for the remainder of their lives. I think you had a whole generation, same thing as you're having black people who are seeing the events play out in Ferguson or Charlotte, North Carolina, or wherever it happens to be this particular week, how those end up just being indelible moments in your life in terms of what racism means, what your life is worth as a black person. I think that's hugely important as well, because he probably saw some of these incidents up close in person in Chicago. Anything else?
Oh, Gus, 10 seconds. The part about, he talked about running through the neighborhood and any nigger could be arrested for running, you know, which is a, you know, I guess a known cliche, but nowadays, or even back then, I think a black person could be killed for anything. He didn't even have to be running. Just recently a man was shot. He was a brain trauma victim, was sitting in his car. And they asked him to get out. He had his kit with him. They killed him, said he had a gun. So I'll mute my line on that. You don't have to be running. They'll get you.
Absolutely.
Because if I could just say, the one missing element from this book so far is just like how you just said. It's the regular white people, the average, everyday white supremacists that you work with and everything, who would, I like the lady said, and Mr. Fuller said, were in trees waiting. You know, they got all kinds of stuff for a Negro rebellion. They can't wait. And the day that things get that out of hand, they would go and take the law into their own hands with no problem. I don't see that element really coming out.
Interesting. That's, we can pay attention to that. We'll have one more segment next week, but the little bit left that we have this week and then next week to see how your average everyday white person is responding to all of this going down in Chicago. Anything else folks want to make sure they get in? Any other observations, comments on retaliation and revenge, or anything else folks think is significant in the book?
I just want to say one last thing. It's important that we talk to our elders about what happened in those days. And my mom was born in 1942. And I had a romantic, like, thing in the back of my head. Like, it was all good when they were in school because they were in all black schools. And my mom told me that, you know, her black teachers were really mean to her. And that made me think when he was talking to the woman about her son, you know, she felt like her son was better off, you know, in the streets selling drugs rather than going to school. The white teachers were horrible and even the black teachers. And I just thought that was so sad. And that made me think about what my mom told me.
Mm-hmm. I thought that portion of what she shared, Shorty's mom, where she said, he don't want no part of school. You know how the teachers is. They hate us. And sometimes the colored ones, the worst. How come they hate us? And it's not even specified if she's talking about the black teachers or the white teachers or all of them. But I think that's why I said when the caller before was saying how things were, quote unquote, better during Reconstruction era. So that would be like post-Civil War, late 1800s, that I'm hesitant because I think sometimes we can romanticize these periods that were horrendous for black people. Not, you know, any point is pretty bad, but I'm very cautious about saying it was glorious for black people in this period in business or education or what have you, because just invariably, I think if you go back and look at the details, you might question that. Anything else folks want to get out?
Yes, I had one thing. This is the last thing. On page 205, Mr. Greenlee wrote, Colonel Evans' first press conference was a near disaster, and the television crew was relieved that they were filming on tape instead of live because of his profanity. He told the members of the press that he intended teaching the people of the area respect for law and order, and that there would be no further nursemaiding of them. He said that he did not believe in special treatment for Negroes. They should stop whining and start working and earn the respect of white citizenry, by demonstrating their worth. Within 24 hours, he announced that things were back to normal and that they were back on the bottom and we are back on top. And this made me think of Dr. John Henry Clark. When he speaks about liberation, he always speaks about liberation coming from the hands of the oppressed and coming from the imagination of the oppressed to how they see it, not to ask your enemy for any sort of reparations in that regard, simply because any version of freedom, quote unquote, that they give you will be just that, them on top and you at the bottom. It'll always be to their advantage. So that is why we have to end the system. We cannot work with them. There's no white allies, none of that. We have to really just put this in complete submission and suppression forever. And then we have to come up with a version of justice and freedom the way we see it and instate that. And they have to either get in where they fit in within the system of justice that we create as the victims of white supremacy. Thank you. And I'll meet my line.
Right on, right on. Anything else? Last comment before we get to the second audio segment? Are folks satisfied?
Larry Tillman-ish, that quote there, Larry Tillman-ish. What's the quote, Gus? The threat of black domination stings over us like this. Yeah, I mean, like, we got to get order back in place by any means necessary before they even get a notion, you know?
Mr. Ben Tillman, former governor in South Carolina, the threat of Negro domination hangs over us like the sword of Damocles. Best quotes, one of the best.
How about the part where they're frantically looking for Muslims, communists, black nationalists, and agitators of any political kind, stripe, or spectrum, and proudly display any they could arrest for incitement to riot or any literature, pamphlet, or signs that they could uncover. You know, this all seems very real because those tactics were used. We know that from the COINTEL program. And I'll mute my line.
McCarthyism.
For sure. And the notion that black people are so stupid that they couldn't possibly have thought on their own, use their, you know, tiny pecan-sized brain to decide to, you know, rebel against us or challenge our authority. Someone must have come along and, you know, got these little colored children and organized and told them to do this. They couldn't have thought this up on their own. I think that's also a pretty regular theme that gets invoked within the system of racism. Anything else? Folks satisfied? We ready to get to the second audio segment?
I have one more thing about retaliation. I found it interesting when you read the meaning of it, that it refers to a counter-military act, because a lot of us don't always think of it that way, but the system of white supremacy is an all-pervasive military act of white supremacy. And anything that they do, it's basically militarily based. They are calculating just like any other military. And because I think of their fear of genetic annihilation, white people are quintessentially good at turning any situation into a life or death situation. And that is why they act how they do. And we have to react in counter to that, because everything they do to us is a life-threatening situation because they're waging war against us. Thank you.
Right on. We will get to the second audio segment. If you have additional comments that you didn't get to share, just make a note, and we should have ample time to share once the second audio segment concludes. So we are kind of, I guess, midway in chapter 17, kind of right after the general has come in, and he's perfect for us, and they're moving forward with their plan. Spook, who sat by the door, Sam Greenlee. After the second audio segment is done, we'll have time for folks to share additional commentary. Context of White Supremacy, audio segment number two.
They had checked weapons and explosives in three large suitcases in the check room at Union Station. Three went to the check room wearing the red caps of the station's porters and checked out the suitcases. Freeman watched it all through the plate glass window of the coffee shop across the big station floor. They got the suitcases with no trouble past the coffee shop without looking at Freeman and went up the stairs to the street above. It was a short distance from the train to the city hall, their destination. There was a bit more than an hour, so Freeman ordered breakfast, eating it slowly and reading about the riots and Vietnam in a newspaper propped against a sugar bowl. He left when he had eaten and walked to an empty corner of the station, sat on a bench, and pretended to be asleep. He had purchased a ticket on the train leaving for Memphis in case a cop might think him a vagrant or bum catching some sleep in the cool station. At a few minutes to three, he entered one of the empty phone booths and dialed the number of the Chicago Sun-Times. He asked for Victor Feldman. "Mr. Feldman, I have a beat for you. I understand you like that kind of thing." "That is the right word. Beat? They stopped using scoop in movies in the 30s, I understand." "Who is this?" "Uncle Tom, the official spokesman for the Black Freedom Fighters of America. We are the Chicago chapter of the Mau Mau." "Look, buddy, if this is some kind of gag, I'm not in the least bit amused." "No gag, baby. And if your watch has a sweep second hand, you can time it. In exactly 48 seconds, you will hear an explosion. Down there on the river, you should be able to hear it very well. 36 seconds now. The explosion will be that of the mayor's nice new office in the nice new city hall, which was built by very, very few black men because of those nasty building trade unions. You know, when the smoke clears, the office will be something of a mess. I think you ought to be able to hear something now." Freeman could hear nothing inside the big railroad station, but he heard a muffled roar through the telephone receiver at his ear. "That's it, Mr. Feldman. Now, you can discount any speculation by the mayor or police that this was an assassination attempt that failed. We blew it when we wanted, and as an advertisement that we mean business. We want the National Guard out of the ghetto, or we will run them out. Then we can talk about how to improve things for the people there. Dig? I'll keep in touch, Mr. Feldman. It's not that we trust you, dig, but you like having a beat, and you might print the truth if it's exclusive. There hasn't been much truth printed about what's been happening on the South Side lately. Remember, we blew the mayor's office when we wanted, when it was empty and he was home in bed. Nobody would want to make that ass into a martyr. Bye now." He hung up, went outside, and drove home. By 4 o'clock, he was asleep. The blowing of the mayor's office made the front pages of the papers the next morning, but only Feldman's column had anything concerning the phone call, and it was played with humor as if a crank call. It did not surprise Freeman, since the mayor, politicians, newspapers, and whites in general would prefer to think it a communist assassination attempt on the mayor. That was all right with Freeman, because the longer they looked for communists, the longer they would be looking for whites. The United States Communist Party used Negroes as showpieces and flunkies, just like all the other American institutions. The best cover they had was the white man's stereotypes concerning Negroes. He called Feldman the next evening and chided him for not printing his phone call on the front page. He announced that the motor car of one of the Negro aldermen would be painted yellow and white. Yellow because he's got no balls, and white because that's his favorite color. It's to let him know what his constituents think of him. Good night, Mr. Feldman. Feldman called the alderman's home, apologized for awakening him, and asked if his car was missing. Upon checking, the alderman found that the car was indeed missing and called the police. The police found it parked in a zone reserved for police vehicles just down the street from the precinct station in the alderman's neighborhood. It had been painted yellow and white. This prank received a small story on page 4, as well as half of Victor Feldman's column. But the incidents spread throughout all of Chicago's ghettos by the grapevine, and they were discussed everywhere. Jokes were told of how Spades had air-conditioned the mayor's office by blowing a hole in the wall. The mayor continued his communist kick, and he was echoed by his black puppet alderman. Other things began to happen, all predicted by Uncle Tom in his nightly phone calls to Feldman. Jeeps, which were not well guarded, ground to a halt on their patrols, their engines ruined by sugar placed in the gas tanks. Other Jeeps were found with all the tires sliced. Signs were painted late at night saying, "Whitey, go home." Prowling military patrols found the frequencies on their radios jammed without warning, and the jamming device would abruptly go off the air before it could be traced to its source. One such device did not go off the air, and when traced by triangulation, was found in the trunk of the colonel's personal Buick Riviera. The occupation troops gradually became objects of humor and ridicule, and their ineptitude, in spite of their spit and polish, became obvious to the mayor, governor, and the city police, who resented being replaced by what they considered amateur, part-time soldiers. The morale of the troops, many of whom were losing pay from their jobs and having been called up, declined sharply, and the ridicule of the people plus the constant harassment of practical jokes took their toll. Freeman set up another raid on the most prominent of the radio stations, beaming their broadcasts to the ghetto audience. Entering the West Side station, wearing nylon stocking masks, they locked up a Negro disc jockey and two engineers in a storeroom and went on the air. "Hey, hey, old Bean, and you too, baby. This is Uncle Tom of the Freedom Fighters, interrupting your favorite program to bring you news of the urban underground dedicated to the cause that Mr. Charlie is a drag and to the inhabitants of occupied territory on the South Side. I'd dedicate this program to the happy members of the National Guard Army of Occupation as well, but I'm afraid we are fresh out of hillbilly music, the Rolling Stones, and the Beatles, even if they are more popular than Christ. How are the happy National Guardsmen, soul brothers and sisters? I see all those pictures of those colorless cats playing football with you and handing out care packages. Or is it just the same old surplus food you've been getting without so much publicity from the welfare? Anyway, if you believe the newspapers, those are the sweetest white soldiers going, even better than the ones who hand out candy in Vietnam to the kids in the village they just burned. Like, if you believe our free press, they must be the most beloved army of occupation since the dawn of history. But we know better, don't we, baby? We know about that 14-year-old kid who was shot last week because he didn't move quick enough, about how law and order is being brought to the lawless South Side, but the numbers and dope peddling still swings, about how they spend more time looking for non-existent communists than they do polishing brass. And you know, baby, they are the brassest polishing army unit in the world. The news is the troops have to go immediately, if not sooner, and if they don't, we will kick them out, including Bullhead Evans. Now, won't we, baby? The freedom fighters, the urban underground of Black Chicago, now deliver this ultimatum: get out by Sunday or be prepared for war. And now, soul brothers and sisters, before the next message from your sponsors, a few jams, some James Brown, Esther Phillips, and the sweet swinging Supremes. Whitey, please go home. We don't want you living next door either. When the police arrived, they found the three locked in the storeroom, the propaganda being aired by tape and no one anywhere around. The Black freedom fighters became the talk of the occupied riot area. Handbills appeared announcing their feats until now, including the capture of the radio station, the broadcast, and the blowing up of the mayor's office. The bills promised more to come. Colonel Evans ordered the arrest of anyone found with a propaganda handbill in his or her possession, and his troops to police the area and pick up the rest of the propaganda leaflets from the streets and alleys. The radio station was guarded thereafter, but the propaganda broadcasts continued with the disc jockey format. The first was broadcast from the alleyway not far from the L station on 51st Street. Guardsmen found a Japanese portable tape recorder playing through a loudspeaker attached high in the steel supports of the L tracks. The first guardsman to climb and attempt to tear down the equipment found that it had been booby-trapped with a wire attached to the metal outdoor speaker, which led to the third rail. The electric shock hurled him to the ground and he was hospitalized. The broadcast continued for a growing crowd until an electrician disconnected it. Each night, at the same time, another broadcast would be made from a similar booby-trapped setup. From the roof of an apartment building, a garbage can in an alley, hidden in a newsstand, and once through the speakers of an army truck which patrolled the neighborhood announcing orders and dispensing National Guard propaganda which had been stolen and parked in an alley. The guard was continuously harassed, and neither arrest, investigation, nor threats could suppress the growing opposition to the troops by both the underground of Freeman's and the populace at large. Evans was furious at being made look a fool by people he held in contempt. He blamed it all on the communists. You know, they would have neither the guts nor the intelligence for this kind of thing if it were not communist-inspired, led, and directed. Let the commies get away with this and the entire nation is in danger. We must make our stand here so that the forces of godless communism are not misled concerning our determination to oppose their plans to take over the free world. The colonel was beginning to embarrass a great many people with his statements, even in a city like Chicago, and his public information officer was used increasingly by the press to water down statements, but he also became a white hope. Colonel Evans had contempt for the repeated demands by the freedom fighters that he and his National Guard be removed or suffer the consequences, and waited with some impatience on the Sunday night of the deadline announced in the communications center of his command post. A bit after 2 a.m, he retired to view a John Wayne movie on late night television. The colonel liked John Wayne movies very much. His National Guard unit had taken over the Washington Park Recreation Center for their headquarters and command post. The old field house sits facing north and across from the large field containing baseball and softball diamonds, a cricket pitch used by the Negro West Indians of the ghetto, and football fields. Separating the field house and the athletic fields is a large drive that cuts through the park from 55th Street at Cottage Grove Avenue, ending at South Park Boulevard. The field house sits in front of the swimming pool complex built by the WPA during the Depression, with 2 Olympic-size pools and a diving pool. Spectator stands flank the pool to the west. The east is flanked by an 8-foot iron fence and high foliage, and to the south is a children's playground. The pool had been refilled for the recreation of the National Guard troops, but since drawing sniper fire was not used at night. Freeman's reconnaissance revealed that the approach to the field house through the pool area was not guarded. At 0:15 after curfew, Freeman led 2 attack teams of 5 men each into Washington Park. A stolen Army ambulance stood at the curb facing north on South Park Boulevard, just adjacent to the children's playground, which was south of the swimming pool area. They entered through the playground, scaled the fence, and crossing the unlit and unguarded concrete area, which held the 2 swimming pools and the diving pool, then entered the locker room of the field house, now the command post and personal quarters of the commander of the guard unit on ghetto occupation duty, Colonel Bull Evans. The locker room had been converted into a private office and bedroom for the colonel, with a small gymnasium above it used for the communications center for the outfit. Freeman slipped into the colonel's empty office, seated himself behind the colonel's desk, poured a generous shot of Jack Daniel Black Label from the bottle on the colonel's desk, and watched an old John Wayne Western on the television in the corner while awaiting the colonel's return from the communications center. Freeman figured that there must be important messages for the colonel to answer to make him missed the beginning of a Western. He thought that the messages might have something to do with Uncle Tom and the Black Freedom Fighters of Chicago. Upon entering the room, his eyes not yet accustomed to the dim light within, the colonel failed to notice the figure behind the desk until he was only a short distance away, his eyes on Wayne on television, whipping 3 men in a barroom brawl. He was reaching for the bottle of bourbon when he noticed the long-barreled Colt target pistol, a silencer fitted to its barrel, pointed at him by Freeman, a black man clad in all black and seated in his chair behind his desk, a glass of his whiskey at the nigger's elbow. The colonel, ignoring the threat of the silenced pistol, reached with the foolish instincts of John Wayne for his holstered, pearl-handled revolver, filling his lungs for a bellow of outrage cut short by an accurate judo chop behind his left ear by Stud Davis, who caught his limp body before he could fall. They carried the colonel back the way they had come, and as silently, slim black figures moving swiftly and efficiently through the sultry, moonless Chicago night. They flung the colonel inside a large mail sack over the fence like a sack of grain, and then into the waiting ambulance, Pretty Willie seated as the driver. The colonel awakened, tied securely to a kitchen chair, his face made up in Jolson blackface with large red lips painted in. The colonel stared back into the dark, silent faces with a look of grim, haughty disdain that would have done justice to Wayne futilely captured by redskins. He watched one of his captors as he carefully placed a drop of liquid onto a sugar cube and put it into a cup of coffee, then approached the colonel with the cup. "What was that you put on the sugar?" "Just a little acid, Daddy." "Acid? You're going to kill me." "Oh, no, Daddy," he said as the colonel was held and he forced the coffee down his throat. "We're going to let you live." The next evening, at the time of his usual call, Uncle Tom informed Feldman where the kidnapped colonel could be found at a particular time and place. The colonel was found alive, as promised, seated on the edge of the reflection pool of the Fountain of Time at the southeast corner of Washington Park. The colonel was dangling his bare feet ecstatically in the pool, a look of beatitude on his face. Upon being medically examined, the colonel was found to be under the influence of LSD and said repeatedly that he had met the most wonderful niggers in the world.
Even under LSD, he still recognized they were niggers. Best niggers in the world, still niggers. Context of White Supremacy. If you have commentary you would like to share, we will end the book next week. So we're going to pick up next week. That was the end of 17. So we'll start next week on chapter 18. And that will be that. So be thinking of, you know, conclusions, major themes, impressions, differences from the film and the book. If you learned anything, people's first time reading the book, all wrapped up next Friday. If you have comments you would like to share, the number to dial 641-715-3640. The code is 564-943-pound. Press *6 if you would like to participate. Everybody who dialed in with a hand up, your line should be open. Please do not wait till the last minute if you think you have a comment, observation, what have you. Like I said, we're wrapping the book up next week, so you should kind of be having whatever your thoughts, takeaways from the book, be getting them together. Folks who dialed in, did you all have commentary?
Yes. I'd like to start this last part about the when they broke into the National Guard. I was comparing that to the movie. Well, up until this part in the book, I think that they said after the riots, there were six killed, or they weren't sure about the number because of the media, you know, but no white people have been killed up to this point. But in the movie, I believe that they killed some of the guards, and even the Bull Evans, the colonel, he got killed also, and but he was ridiculed before he was killed. And you know, it seems like, you know, something that's been used over and over, the taking over a radio station and then broadcasting. We've seen it in some of Spike Lee's movies. And then in the old war movies, World War II, where Tokyo Rose was broadcasting, you know, propaganda. So it's realistic, you know, and I guess calling the newspaper, you know, to get the press would actually make it seem like a bigger operation than it really was. But I'll mute my line and let others take a shot at it.
Other folks who are on, thank you, Mr. Demery, for. Other folks have comments?
Can I be heard?
Yes, sir.
All right. Greetings, Gus. You had me laughing when you were closing out just now. You were talking about his recognition of them still being niggas. I literally split my side because it just hit me that way. But you were so accurate, though. It wasn't funny as in being completely comedic, but it just hit me in that way when you said that. I think this part really exemplifies the importance of propaganda, like Mr. Demery Ford was saying. And it made me think of the war between the Hutu and the Tutsis, because the radio was used as a means of actually capturing and killing other Africans. And they learned that tactic from white people. Of course, a lot of that was done in Germany with the Jews as well. And the Nazis, it was a very similar thing where radio was used for propaganda and also to find specific people that they wanted to capture and or kill or both for any reason. So I think that was just very important, the way that happened, or the way that was set up in the book. I thought was really well done. Also, I liked the tactics that he used in regards to the military tactics, as far as him setting up and executing his plan. It kind of reminds me of Minister Malcolm when he discusses the Vietnamese fighting the Americans, and how the Americans went into Vietnam with all their sophisticated weapons and carpet bombs and napalm and all of this stuff. And he said, you know, the Vietnamese just had a bowl of rice, you know, some pants, some boots, and, you know, an AK-47, and they were able to handle the U.S. government with all their fancy stuff. You know, they had the tunnels built under heavy sections of Vietnam, which protected them from the carpet bombs and things like that. They would pop up on the soldiers and take them out in clandestine ways and then jump back into the tunnels and all of these things. They had to create tunnel rats, which were white people they would send into these tunnels to try and get the Vietnamese, and they would usually end up dead. So, I mean, like, he had the guerrilla tactics down really well, and I thought that was outlined and executed well in the book. I'm looking forward to, like Thomas said, seeing how the white people react, because as it moves forward, like I said, I read this book quite a long time ago, so it's almost like reading it for the and ultimately I want to see how every white Duck Dynasty citizens, you know, react to this situation. So thank you for taking my call, and I'll mute my line. Oh yeah, there's one more thing I wanted to touch on, my bad. It was actually one thing that I highlighted. It was the colonel awakened Tizer Curley to a kitchen chair, his face made up in a Jolson black face with large red lips painted in. The colonel stared back into the dark, silent faces with a look of grim, haughty disdain that would have done justice to Wayne futilely captured by Redskins. I found that telling because the black face is actually the origin of clowns. Clowns, that's why clowns have big, broad noses. That's why they paint those giant lips, and that's why they wear afros like Ronald McDonald. So I just found it, and recently, of course, we've had across the country these rogue clowns walking around with swords and knives, threatening people and terrorizing areas. So I just thought it was interesting they made them up in blackface, which is, of course, blackface is the origin of the clown. It's just in reverse, but it's a white face with black features. Thank you, and I'll meet my line there.
Appreciate that, Roz. Other folks have comments they wanted to share?
Well, I really appreciated them talking about the use of propaganda. I mean, it's like their number one weapon against black people. Propaganda, and they spread propaganda about black people in the U.S. from one end of the globe until the other. But we never put out any propaganda on them, but I think that if we just actually told the truth about them, that would probably be the equivalent of their propaganda, just telling the truth. But we seem to keep their secrets, whether they are sadistic, perverted, criminal, despotic. We keep those secrets. They never get out. You know, every once in a while, a Jerry Sandusky will come to the core. But for the most part, I don't even think we need propaganda. We just need to tell each other the truth about white people, and then it would be over with. But we can't bear to say.
Appreciate that, Karma. Other folks have commentary they wanted to share. Anything else from the second audio segment? Hopefully people will not wait till the last moment. The other person that dialed in from a blocked number, did you have commentary?
Hello?
Yes, ma'am.
Can I be heard? Yeah. Hold on, let me take this. Okay, can I be heard better now?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, yeah, I wanted to take off the speakerphone. Hope I didn't cause any problems. As you all know, I'm very late to the show, but I'm a first-time caller. My name is Zima. I actually had a question that, you know, I'd like as many people to answer as possible. I definitely believe I hope I can ask a question that may not be related to tonight's show in particular or, you know, the audio sessions. Is that okay?
I try to stay on task with the book study because people tend to tarry from the topic and end up talking about all kinds of other things. So if it's totally unrelated to the spook who sat by the door, if you want to wait perhaps until the end of the program and then we can make time to ask, we can do that, and or you could dial in tomorrow for the compensatory call-in when that sort of thing is welcome and the whole program is dedicated to that, so you could share and, you know, get people to respond.
Okay, it might be better that I wait to the end of the show. However, I will say that it possibly could be related because someone made a statement about genetic annihilation, and so it was related to that. So should I just go ahead and wait to the end of the show, or would I ask that?
Yeah, that's not really related to the book. So if you want to wait till the end of the program, that would be fine.
Yes, definitely.
Okay.
Yes, and I'll meet my line.
For sure. Appreciate that. Other folks have commentary? Spook who sat by the door? All right. Notes that I had, and again, there are folks who have a question or observation or what have you. Please do not wait till the end. Go ahead and get your hand up. Some of the things that stood out to me, I think it's important. I appreciate, and particularly for this context, him putting alongside the rebellions, also known as riots, that were happening in the U.S., putting that side by side with Vietnam, which many black people of that time period, Assata Shakur, Minister Malcolm X, Dr. King, did that consistently in pointing out white supremacy as a global system problem. I appreciated that in the text. And same thing with him mentioning the Mau Maus and comparing freedom fighters, the civil rights, what they call civil rights advocates of the 1960s, and putting them again side by side with the Mau Maus. These are black people in Kenya who resorted to counterviolence in dealing with racism, white supremacy. One thing that I would say in terms of what Karma talked about, the importance of telling the truth, that we don't need propaganda, we just need truth. And I was going to add in with that, I think also whites, they do a lot of terrorizing us so that we are not truthful. I was thinking of the black male this week. He's at the University of Wisconsin, Madison. He had sweatshirts that said all white people are racist. That's that propaganda. There you go. But he got all these death threats and everything else. And I think that is standard. If you are a black person and you're working to just tell the truth about racism, what it is, how it works, you can be intimidated, threatened, even killed for that. So I think that's a big part of the fear, the hesitation that many of us have. But I think just in the vein of telling the truth, when we mention the Mau Maus, it is accurate. I would say it is necessary. Yes, the Mau Maus in Kenya, they did resort to counterviolence. They did kill individuals classified as white, representatives of Britain, I believe. In retaliation, using that word specifically in context, in retaliation, I think the Mau Maus reportedly killed like we'll say 100 people. I think it might have been less than that. But let's say they killed 100 white people. White Britons, they killed like 1,000 black people. Like to, you know, snuff, like it was no comparison to death. Like this is not something, in my view, that if you look at it logically, you can be like, yeah, we showed them. We kicked their behind. Like, not at all. Like, massive black suffering happened as a result of this. Not saying that what they did was incorrect, but just there is a massive power differential in the system of white supremacy. And I think that sort of thing, being honest about that, I think that, in my view, contributes to why Dan Freeman consistently says he does not do this with joy. You know you're going to have casualties. You know that this is going to be very, very difficult. You have a formidable opponent. This is not something that I do. Yes, this is gleeful. Got to go out and stick it to white. That's not his position at all. And I think that's just being accurate, professional, counter-racist soldier. Moving forward, I thought it was just significant because Shorty's mom, she was talking about how they moved the jobs out of the North. They moved them south to places where they didn't have unions. And then it says in this section that the buildings in Chicago, like the mayor's office, they were built by very few black men because of those nasty building trade unions. So they do have unions for the trade building industry, but there's still racism, white supremacy. So union, no union, you're still going to have a tough time as a black person. Next. I was reminded of that I'm going to call Cabral quote, even the propaganda where they're calling in to the news station to report about what they did. Seemed like it could have been bragging in some respect. I know this sort of thing is done before, but I don't know. That just kind of came to mind from the quote from the first section that I read. The portion where on their recording where they say we know better about the 14-year-old who was killed that didn't get reported in the news. I think a lot of that happens almost every time we have one of these incidents. The conflicting reports about the protester who died in Charlotte, North Carolina, where they said it was a protester. And then other people said it was the police. They fired something into the crowd, and that's what caused this fatality. I think that's consistent. The paragraph in the Spook continues about how law and order is being brought to the lawless South Side, but the numbers and dope peddling still swings. I thought that was really important, just showing that regardless legalization or prohibition of narcotics, white people are in charge. And even reminds me of right now where they talk about in prisons, you have this endless flow of drugs that is, of course, regulated by the white guard. You couldn't have it if it was not. That's what racism, white supremacy means. If we want the drugs to be here, we will allow them to be here. If we don't want them here, they won't be here. If we can come in and put the National Guard and stop everything except drugs, alcohol. And again, in my mind, it shows me racists, they understand that sobriety would be best under conditions of war, white supremacy. I thought it was significant the name Supremes coming out. I think we had Bob Law and others on the programs who just talked about how the difference just on so many levels in terms of black self-respect when you have names like the Supremes, as opposed to, and many others of that era, but the Supremes. And then you compare that to now where it's, you know, Snoop Dogg and Lil Bow Wow and, you know, other types of names that are not lacking in black self-respect. I'll say it that way. John Wayne, I think, they just had the big to-do in California about honoring him with a day, and this is someone who bragged about his investment in white supremacy. I thought even Colonel Bull, Connor Bull, would be another Welsing moment. I think she talked extensively about what the bull represents in white supremacy, white genetic annihilation, and another Welsing moment with the Jack Daniel black label. That might even be a twofer with the consumption of dark liquids like the coffee that they gave the general, Coca-Cola, chocolate, that sort of thing. And the better grade of Jack Daniels is the black label Jack Daniel. Next. In fact, I think in this portion, we get both views about cannabis or drugs, period. I think before it said, as the gang codified, they lost interest in pot altogether. Ultimately, they started using drugs as a part of their counterattack. They were putting holes, taking hypodermic needles and putting the holes in their arms to fool people into thinking that they were junkies when they were not using at all. And then when they capture Evans, they drug him so that he loses credibility when it goes out. It looks like, you know, he was doing whatever since they don't kill him in the book. But I thought that was hugely important, and in a subtle way is kind of reinforcing, in my view, sobriety would be best, even though there's a lot of normalized cigarette smoking and alcohol consumption in the book. And I think that would, you know, it'd be better to exclude that as well. I will stop there. Folks have other questions they want to get in. I was going to ask also if folks thought the significance of there not be the general is not killed in the book, and you don't have any other whites killed at this point in the book. In the movie, that is a difference that was already pointed out with the general. He gets killed, and several other white soldiers also are killed by this point in the movie. Why that difference is there, if folks wanted to comment on that. The caller, retired firefighter, did you have comments you wanted to get in, sir?
Can I be heard?
Yes, sir. We're not hearing you now. We were hearing you before, but we're not hearing you now.
I think you muted me. Yeah. Where are we right now? Because I just tuned in. Are we at the midway point, or?
We've already had both of the audio segments for the book study, so we're just commenting on what we just heard and just final thoughts from this week's readings.
So the riot took place, and it evolved into the guerrilla warfare yet?
The National Guard was called in. They captured Colonel Bull Evans. They drugged him and then released him. They blew up the mayor's office. They did some of their radio propaganda programs, kind of explaining themselves as black freedom fighters. That's kind of the gist of what took place this week.
Okay. Well, I really don't have any comment. Just kind of like I'll just listen unless something else comes up.
Right on.
I'm on the road right now. It's stuck in traffic, and there's a lot of emergency lights ahead of me. So,
wow.
I'll speak up if something is worthy of me to join in with.
Yes, sir. Stay safe on the road, retired firefighter. Man.
Yes, sir.
The caller at 5771, did you have commentary? 5771.
Real quick, I came in on the second session. I noticed the reference to football a lot, and, you know, that can be a Welsing moment in regards to, you know, how she talks about sports. But also, too, being that this is, you know, this being late in the book, you know, the war or the, you know, the guerrilla warfare going on with Dan's army and the National Guard, you know, football is sort of a military symbolism. You know, it's basically a military type sport. You know, you have the phrases in football, blitz and all those other things, you know, representing, you know, military and, you know, the violence in football represents, military and warfare. Also, too, it's interesting the scene of, you know, South Park Drive. You know, now it's currently Martin Luther King Drive. And, you know, I think I heard somebody say, you know, most of the streets in all of the, you know, some of the major public major cities that is named Martin Luther King Drive are one of the most violent. So I thought that was pretty interesting. That's all I have. I'll keep my line.
I think Thomas in New York, did you have a comment you were going to add, sir?
Yes, can I be heard?
You're a little distant.
Can I be heard?
That's better.
Thank you. Yes, he's right, man. Football uses a lot of military terms, you know, firepower, guards, defense, offense, you know, just a lot. I think the book difference from the movie might have been why they okayed the movie in the first place and let it go because they read the book and they said, okay, you know, if he's not really going that far with it, it's kind of borderline. Maybe this is something we can put out. And then when they saw the movie, they were like, oh, no, we got to take this out and tear this ASAP. I think that could have been one of the reasons why I was taking out the theaters and why they okayed it. Because if it had all the killing in it in the book, I doubt they would have okayed the movie in the first place. That is their Hollywood. The palace, you know, you mentioned the scenario. I think, you know, when you talk revenge and retaliation, no one practices it. I mean, now, United States, we already know what you're up against, but Israel has been the white country that has, I think, practiced it better than anyone. You know, the Palestinians killed 20, and they'll say just like this in the news, you know, Palestinian suicide bomber kills 20 Jews in an act of revenge, and then in retaliation, the Jews are going to blow up 20 blocks. You know, it's not a comparison. I think that the propaganda, the way it's used in the book, is it's very good. However, propaganda is always being used against us because we don't own the outlets of propaganda. And all the outlets of propaganda are controlled. You know, it's their radio, it's their internet. And I see it being used against us a lot. I sent you some articles how they used some counterintelligence software in Chicago during the time when they had the Laquan McDonald and they were marching around and the police was using, able to hack into everyone in a certain area, social media, to find out certain information about where they're going to be going next and what plans they might have had. And I sent you another article, I think, last week where they showed that they were doing the same thing in New York during the Eric Garner. They were using it in St. Louis. And it all started in Oakland. They used this software. The guy from Fruitvale Station was killed by the cops, and they had a little uprising. I can't figure out.
Oscar Grant.
On the tip of my brain. Absolutely, that's it. It was on the tip of my brain. I just couldn't get it out. But they were showing how they used this software and pretty much use your internet against you, in your social media, which you think is, private. To a certain extent, they know your next move. So they don't even have to guess anymore. Everything is posted. And the last thing I wanted to say is, man, a huge point that's, I think that he points out in the book that's very false is that these white people are underestimating the black people, it's not them, but I just haven't seen that historically, and I think that some of the, especially the last book, how under Seville the black movements were. This is the J. Edgar Hoover era, even this book. The movie, I think, was a year after he left the post, but he didn't let too much get past him. I mean, if you were planning anything, he had someone playing it in there with you. So I think that that's a little bit misleading. Where's the FBI, And I'll be more. Thank you.
Point well taken. Any other comments folks wanted to make sure they get in?
Yes, you can hear.
Let's get Mr. Demery for.
Yeah, no problem.
Okay. Well, we were talking about the military, and they mentioned the National Guard coming in with the care packages similar to candy that the
soldiers would give out to the Vietnamese after they had just burned their village, then it just points to the propaganda, the media supporting the system of white supremacy. At the end, it says, like, if you believe our free press, they must be the most beloved army of occupation since the dawn of history. So these images go out, and you can even see them today, where they'll show a National Guardman giving a small child a bottle of water or something to that effect, like they're being gentle and aiding. And in reality, they are there to continuously harass, arrest, investigate, and suppress growing opposition. So, yeah, the media helping out. And one last thing I was going to say when it comes to the software to, you know, I guess monitor, you know, your IP address is a way that they can track, you know, exactly where you are and who you are. So a VPN may be something that listeners want to consider, because I just recently became acquainted with it and I have it. So you don't want too much information about yourself out there when you're trying to replace white supremacy with justice, all counter-racist measures and strategies should be tried. I'll mute my line, Gus. Thanks for taking the call. Good night.
Appreciate that. Raj, you were going to comment, sir?
Yes. I was going to say he's absolutely right, because I used to be online. I had a Facebook page. I had a MySpace page. And in 2007, I got rid of it, and it was because of the experiences I had after having long contact and debates online and in different websites. I got a reputation, and eventually I realized that I was being watched. Just some things that were happening to me, and eventually a close friend of mine ended up committing suicide, and that was in 2008. And so it just kind of changed a lot for me. So I don't really mess with anything online. The only thing I really mess with at this point, as far as social networking, is the BTR community that Scotty Reed started on, Black Talk Network. And it's actually really good, and it's gratifying to have positive contact with like-minded counter-racist Black people. I was going to say as well that when Thomas brought up the idea that it was false in regards to white people underestimating Black people, and I wholeheartedly agree, but it really made me think of Nat Turner and the fact that Nat Turner sold the movies out, so the resurgence of that is here. And after recently finishing The Delectable Negro, there's a whole section on Nat Turner there that's profound. And I believe that for all, because Nat Turner's insurrection was the largest one of its kind on the mainland United States, I think he was the one who put that in their minds about not underestimating us. And it has nothing, it's taking nothing away from all of the other rebellions that Blacks instated to try and free themselves by any means necessary. But that particular incident really made them, in my opinion, look at us in a way in which they would never put their guard down again. And what we're living through, and what even Sam Greenlee lived through, like Thomas accurately stated, is the fact that they were never going to allow something like that to happen again. So at this point, and even at the point that Mr. Greenlee wrote this book, that was an inaccurate observation. So I totally, an inaccurate relaying of that type of scenario as far as that aspect of the text. So I definitely agree with that. I also wanted to say that them drugging the colonel reminded me of the story that was told on one of the programs you did earlier. Knowing you with that memory of yours, Gus, you'll probably pull it out. But there was a discussion on Paul Robeson when he had gone to a party somewhere in Europe, and they tried to drug him with LSD. And they had put enough LSD in the drink to practically kill him. But he only had a couple of sips of it. And from those couple of sips, he actually almost died. Like, he almost lost his mind. Do you remember that?
Yep, that was John Patash, his second visit this year, drugs as a weapon against us. He talked about about that specifically.
Yes, it reminded me of that because I also had a guy I went to school with in high school, a white guy who was actually really smart, one of the smarter kids in the school, who got hooked on LSD, and his mind was never the same, and it seems like they gave him enough of LSD to have him in that kind of stupor where his mind was messed up probably for the rest of his life. So I found that to be interesting that was the route they took in the book. And what was your question in regards to, I know you were asking a question about something, the difference between the book and the movie. What was the question? Can you please repeat it?
That they're in the book, they, at this point, no whites have been killed. Whereas in the movie, by this point, the general has been killed and several other members of the National Guard have also been killed by this point in the movie.
Okay. I think the reason why in the movie, by this point, those people were killed and in the book they're not, is because probably a part of it might have had to do with time, because he had to tell the story within a certain amount of time. The other thing is, I think he would not have wanted to show the concept of black thought being that complex, to the point of thinking of drugging someone, to the point of leaving them in that sort of mental stupor, and it being a white person. In other words, I don't think he would have felt that things would have really gone down well, or they might have even released it, had they shown black people being able to do to white people what white people have done to us, in other words. And then also, I think maybe too, he might have wanted to make a certain type of statement to black people in regards to what we're going to need to do when that time comes, when we collectively, united, and dependently come to the point where enough of us have come to the realization of what the system's about, and we make a collective decision to do something actively in a counter-violent manner to overthrow the system, that these are the things that we're going to have to face dealing with. But again, I'm waiting to see, you know, when Duck Dynasty comes out, because you know how white people are. They're going to come out wholesale and just get busy with, you know, killing as many black people as possible. When you brought up the whole thing with the Mau Mau killing, say, 100 white people, and then white people killing, like, literally, it's like 1,000%. So it's like 900% more of us than we killed of them. And that's how they think. That's how they function, you know. So I think that that's my insight into why the difference between the two, in my opinion. And thank you, and I'll meet my line.
Right on. That is our commentary. We did our 3 hours. We will wrap this book next Friday, 8 p.m. Eastern, 5 p.m. Pacific. If you're listening to the archives and you have a concluding thought that you want to share, we can read it on the program next week before we transition. I think we're doing Lothrop Stoddard, The Rising Tide of Color Against White World Supremacy. I think that'll be our next book, not next week, but 2 weeks from today. But that might change, but I'm pretty sure that's what it will be. Not read by Gus T. Renegade, thank goodness. Our female caller, who you were going to posit your question, I don't know what it's going to be. We'll see if it's going to require a longer response. People can ponder on it, and then I'll repitch tomorrow so people can ponder over it. But what was your question going to be, ma'am?
Okay, you talking about me?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, well, that also lets me know I can be heard. Greetings to everybody. My question was, what do you all think, I mean, if you see this, that Europeans go against their genetic survival by promoting that people sleep with other Europeans? You see, you can sort of see that in the movie, in the media rather, where they push that. And I remember, I believe you said on a show, Gus, that someone named Eric Hamilton said that if enough of us refuse to sleep with Europeans, that they would probably respond with violence. And so that was ultimately my question. Like, why would they promote things that would go against their genetic survival? Because it seems like that, you know, they would want that they would want that genetic survival, like Dr. Chris Wilson and Neely Fuller says. Like, that seems like that is something that that they're definitely concerned with, but yet at the same time, they promote things that go against that. So I was just kind of curious about that, confused about it, really. And I'll meet my line.
Right on. That sex thing, I said that before. It pops up all the time. That's why we have a limit on not bringing that up on the Saturday program or what have you, because just a lot of focus ends up being there. It is important, but that is just an observation I've had. My quick response, that is something that we've discussed on the program before. I know Dr. Welsing addressed that specifically on an earlier broadcast. My abbreviated response would be that whites, different messages and different displays register differently based on your understanding of racism, white supremacy. I think the typical white person, they understand that they can sexually terrorize black people, non-white people at their leisure, on the job, at school, wherever. Like, you know, have fun, do whatever you want to do, raping niggers, all of them, males, females, children, whatever. However, when it gets serious and it's about procreation and marriage, leave the niggers alone. Whites have that. So these promotions of sexual intercourse, really whites being able to rape non-white people, it's generally going to be something really trashy like scandal, loving. It's going to be that type of display. This totally benefits racism, white supremacy, because us non-white people being confused, not having accurate understanding of racism, we think that this is somehow white validation, white people accepting us, treating us, seeing us as humans. Racists understand that's not what it is at all. This is just more of us being able to sexually terrorize them and completely ruin their brain computers with these intimate acts, these intimate violations of them, that this totally works for us. So I think a lot of it is just not understanding what these images and representations are, even if it's picking out black people, black males that are married to white women and really playing that up, whatever it happens to be. All of this, it supports racism, white supremacy. I could say more than that, but I will leave it there. Again, we've talked about this in previous programs. Dr. Welsing has talked about this specifically. I can probably put a hand on an archive or two, given some time that goes into more detail. If folks want to, well, actually, it wouldn't be tomorrow because we don't do Area 8 on the compensatory call-in, but I'm sure we'll be on every day for the next week and a half, so people will have opportunity to comment on that if they are so inclined. With that, we will wrap things. We will be here in about 24 hours, compensatory call-in. We'll be here Sunday early. It'll be 3 p.m. Eastern, 12 noon Pacific this Sunday, the Global Sunday Talk on Racism. We'll be here on Monday, the white woman. She wrote a book about how whites deliberately exclude black professors, black faculty members from white institutions, universities, colleges. It was published, her white woman explaining this. It was published in the Washington Post, a few other outlets on Tuesday. The book Blood at the Root, written by a white male. He'll be on the program this coming Tuesday. It's about the racial cleansing in Forsyth County. On Wednesday, Allison Manswell, she wrote the book Listen In, about workplace racism. Thursday, we'll have our own workplace racism segment. A week from today, we have our last study session on Nat Turner. Next Saturday, the compensatory call-in. And then a week from Sunday, Charles Woods, black male. He will be here to talk about the history, context of racism and entertainment, film, television. In fact, might even be a good person to ask that very question about the promotion of sexual intercourse between whites and non-whites in TV. But that'll be next Sunday. If you have questions, get confused, drop an email, untiljustice@gmail.com, untiljustice@gmail.com. Thanks, everyone, tuning in. I hope it has been a constructive investment of your Friday evening. Sobriety would be best under conditions of white supremacy. I'm reminded again of the Cobras. Their process of codification seemed to involve not consuming narcotics. Everything, alcohol, cigarettes, you name it, should be in there. Sobriety would be best under conditions of white terrorism. We want to be able to make phenomenal counter-racist decisions at all time and make sure that our conduct reflects
that war is being waged against us in all areas of people activity worldwide. With that, Creator, we ask that you help us remain patient with other black people, victims of white supremacy. We ask that you help us remain patient with ourselves. Remind us to demonstrate the highest levels of black self-respect at all times, in all places, each and every time we are in contact with another black person. It has been time. Replace white supremacy with justice immediately. Cow signing out. Thanks all for tuning in.
Nigga, you so brainwashed.
I'm a victim,
your
brother.
Problem. You're a victim.
I'm a victim of 400 years of conditioning.
Shut up.
The man has programmed my conditioning.
Mm-hmm.
Even my conditioning has been conditioned.